Ladies and gentlemen, we are live. Thank you so much for joining us on this Tuesday, the 14th day of June 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're going to be live here for the next 4 hours. Obviously, we're going to be talking about the biggest mass shooting in U.S. history that took place Saturday night. We've learned a lot more about this. I've studied Islam. I've studied the jihadist. I've studied the Wahhabist. And the more Wahhabist you get, the more you're into having sex with little boys. And the more you're also into going to gay nightclubs. And so I said, this is latent homosexual behavior. This is a guy obsessed with it, probably into it, who then is guilty about it. So he decides to run his jihad that he's going to launch for ISIS against the gay nightclub, which is exactly what we now learn. He frequented the place. He was there quite a bit. And hung out with the folks there. And this is just all part of the schizophrenia of Islam, where it talks about having sex with young boys and how that's okay and young girls. But if an adult does it, you've got to be killed. I mean, it should be the opposite. You go after kids, that's when you have the problem, because they don't have the age of consent. See, that's how it is in the West. Everything is ass backwards. Orlando shooter. Omar Mateen was a regular at the Pulse nightclub. Customers had seen killer there before, and several reports getting messages from him on gay dating apps. So, he's out there going around the different apps online, reportedly, and it just all fits the MO. And he's got this family, this father, you know, going on the internet saying kill the gays, and you've got his imam saying it. And none of that is really in the news. It's all how gun owners are evil. It's all how gun owners are bad. It's all how we have to pay. In fact, Hillary Clinton has said it's the internet which she wants to censor that's the problem, and guns. And the FBI has come out and said he was radicalized on the internet. Okay, he traveled to Saudi Arabia repeatedly. That's where he actually went to get the final training. But the idea that, like, well, the man used a car to run people over. He used the highway. He used a car. I saw the different Democrat-run website headlines where, see the gun that committed the crime. No, a gun didn't commit the crime. And I know our audience knows that, but Obama's not ruling out coming after the Second Amendment with more executive action. Hillary says she wants to ban the semi-autos. This is incredible. When she's the lady, it came out yesterday, who ordered the State Department not to investigate his mosque years ago when she was still in the State Department. And it just fits the same MO over and over and over again, where they are protecting these people. Meanwhile, Donald Trump, you know, came out yesterday and said, look, we really have a stupid president. We have a moron president. He said, we're led by a fool, to give you the actual quote. And he went on to say, or there's something else, he knows exactly what he's doing. And the Washington Post came out and said that he was implying that Obama was behind it. No, he implied that Obama knows this stuff's going to happen, is going to take our guns once the attacks start. That isn't saying Obama's running it, but he is opening the door up and bringing the people in, which is pretty much the same thing. So this is a case of Trump having his cake and eating it too, and really dragging the media through the mud. I personally love it, where he puts it out there. They say what he really wants to say. For him, he pulls back, doesn't get the heat, but still gets the truth out. A master tactician, the centipede, is an incredible predator of other predators and injects its poison with twin fangs. All right, ladies, there's an internet meme, if you don't know, that likens him to the centipede. Maybe we should play some of that today. That always cheers Buckley up when we're out at brunch or something with the kids, and we sit there and watch Donald Trump videos together. All right, we'll be right back. Stay with us. Dr. Steve Pachenik, who the Jack Ryan character in Patriot Games is loosely based on, co-author of many of Tom Clancy's books, will be joining us. He, of course, is a psychiatrist, a medical doctor, a graduate of Harvard and MIT, and was the psych warfare head that way back at the Camp David Accords with the only successful peace treaty with the Muslims. And, of course, he's one of the founding members of Delta Force. The list just goes on and on. He comes on every few months here. He's going to give us his breakdown on the Orlando event. Now, I wanted to get him on the last few months about a book he wrote about Europe escaping the Holocaust and coming finally to the United States via Cuba and then Canada. And it goes through all the things that his mother went through. I've now read the book online. It's amazing. But he, instead of really getting to that, wants to cover Orlando, so that's fine. But it's a really interesting perspective of Pechenik because, I mean, he's somebody who actually had family die in the Holocaust. There are a lot of folks out there that claim they did, kind of like folks claiming they, you know, have cancer to raise money on the internet or whatever. And a lot of times it turns out it's not true. But in Pechenik's case, it is true. He has a very interesting perspective on how some of the Jewish leadership blocked Jews getting out of Europe unless they paid money to the Jewish leadership to be able to get out of the country. So he can really break down the truly sickening underbelly of the Jewish mafia and what it basically did to his family and many others. And that's not really the full scope of the book, but you need to understand that went on. And that was very real. And I don't bring that out to demonize Jews, but criticism of Jewish mafia or Jewish organizations is not anti-Semitism. So the Jewish mafia has hidden behind that for a long time and gotten away with a lot of its activities. And of course, the Jewish mafia founded the ADL in 1913. You can look that up for yourself as well. So I'm going to expose the Saudi mafia, the Chinese communist mafia, elements of the Jewish mafia. I'm going to expose the socialist German mafia, the socialist French mafia. I'm going to expose the globalists here in this country. I'm just going to expose organized crime across the board. I'm going to expose the Russian mafia, the Japanese mafia, the Mexican mafia. I'm going to go after Mecha and La Raza. I'm going to go after all these groups that operate the same. You see, I'm with the Patriot mafia. And you can say the Patriot family, but see, it's an idea, and anyone can be a member of it. It transcends how these other mafias base their operations. Because if they make it about race or religion, they don't have to then actually deliver anything to their family. They can just all make it about we're in a group, and they end up abusing and feeding on their own group. 9 times out of 10, your own, quote, mafia is your worst nightmare. I want a unified culture on the Bill of Rights, Constitution, religious freedom, family freedom, incredibly low taxes, based on stewardship, based on ingenuity, based on rugged individualism, based on inventiveness, based on exploration, based on trailblazing, based on free association. It's called the Renaissance. I'm into it. And America is the great flower of that. But because we were so successful, we got infested with organized crime, all battling with each other for full control. And they've run the nation into the ground, and we're going to be exposing it big time. Got a call last night from Jesse Ventura at about 5 o'clock. I'd gone early yesterday and to be with my children, and he called me, and he said, I may come on your show first tomorrow and break down the fact that my case that I won in the federal court for defamation against Chris Kyle, the sniper, America's most deadly sniper, Navy SEAL. But then he called this morning and he said, no, I'm going to hold back. My lawyer wants me to hold back, but I'll come on your show first as soon as I decide to speak. But he told me some stuff and said, but you're welcome to repeat this on air or put it in an article. And I'll just say this. He's completely blown away because the federal overturn of his case had over 60 major corporations sign on to a lawsuit. Big media, the New York Times, CNN, you name it, News Corp, saying we want to be able to lie. And we don't want there to be, when we're found guilty of lying, we don't want there to be any basically monetary payment for it. And that's actually what the federal court is saying, is that the media will be able to lie. And even if you win a case, there basically won't be any money. And, of course, Ventura spent over $1.5 million on the suit, most of the money he has. And that's what he won. And the reason they overturned it, they said, was the jury was allowed to know that Ventura was not suing the family and that there was insurance and that the widow had made over $45 million as of trial time on the book itself, and that the couple million dollars that Ventura was going to get just for basically his court costs and getting his name back was going to be paid by an insurance company. And Ventura was only able to bring that up in trial. They have the transcripts because they brought it up. We're like, this poor widow, he's suing her. He wants to make her, you know, basically bankrupt. And so Ventura's lawyers could come in, who are some of the best in the country, and go, oh, actually, she's gotten $40-plus million off the book, tens of millions off the movie, and she doesn't even pay this. She keeps the money. The insurance company pays it. The publisher on the book alone had $20 million in coverage. Ventura was seeking $1.5 million. Going shooting super low for what they'd spent on the trial where they fought him for 2 years, even getting it to court. So instead, Ventura trying to get his name back is, and listen, I don't think Chris Kahl was a bad guy. People I know that know him say that, you know, the movie's pretty accurate. I think the guy was a patriot. I don't know how he got convinced or confused to say he beat up Ventura. Ventura didn't do it, has the witnesses, would never say things like that, that he's glad Navy SEALs are dying. It was meant to destroy his name. And as soon as Chris Kyle's story started degenerating, magically somebody killed him up in Dallas at a shooting range, if you really believe that. And Kraft, or people dressed in Kraft uniforms, were at the Boston bombing. Probably there running security. Guys with black backpacks and tan, wearing Punisher hats. We began to investigate that. Not saying they were involved, but saying Obama clearly was protecting the bombers or whoever they were connected to. It turned out one of the brothers was on CIA payroll. That came out in the Boston Globe. It was on local Boston radio that morning that they were running a drill of a bombing. I don't know exactly what happened, but there's a cover-up. Is it to cover up a Saudi connection? I don't know, but there's something going on there. The media misrepresents it and says that, you know, I say that Chris Kyle did it. That's not what we ever said. We just said that. Look, that's how Kraft International dresses. They wear tan boots, pants, jackets, black backpacks, and Punisher hats. He popularized that. Now, it could have been somebody else. We just said, wow, that's a Kraft International contractor outfit. Boom, he's dead right after that. Okay, I mean, it's like Pat Tillman. I've talked to his brother. Pat Tillman was going to come out about government growing the opium, how we were working and not stopping the Taliban and Al-Qaeda, which later all came out. They killed him. And the army coroner, who was a colonel, would not lie in the autopsy and said he was murdered. He was executed. They shot him. He fell behind a rock, his own unit. He said, what are you doing? It's me. It's me. He jumped up going, what is your effing problem? They shot him again and then came up and did a single burst, three shots right across the front of the face. At feet away, powder burns, read the autopsy. They shot him, didn't take him down because of body armor, crept up on him and killed him deader than a hammer. Private Lynch was going to be, you know, the feminist icon of how the men cowered in fear, but she defeated them all. None of it was true. Her own unit started speaking out. They killed four of them in 1 week. People be having a barbecue at their house, and a guy in a black uniform and a mask would pop up and double tap him in the head at 50 yards and then pop back down. Or you'd get pulled over and then be found dead in a puddle of water. And then Lynch came out and said, it's all fake. It's all fake. I was told a lie. Jerry Bruckheimer was producing it. It was all, yeah, Jerry Bruckheimer. Now, I don't bring all this out because I'm against our military. I bring all this out because I'm against it being used in these ways and these type of propaganda pieces. So I don't know what happened with Chris Kyle, okay? And I'm not even choosing sides here. I know Jesse Ventura. I'm the one that gave him the news. They waited until he drove in his RV to Mexico to announce all this. And he said, you're joking, Alex. That's not true. Come on. And then I told him, he was blown away. And he spent all this time. And look, I disagree with Ventura on a lot of his politics. But the guy's for real. He means well. And they tried to destroy his good name so he couldn't run for president. That's what all this was about. Kyle got roped in. I guarantee you, News Corp talked him into putting that section in the book as a psyop. And either that or the Boston bombing is the reason he was executed. I don't buy this story that some guy with PTSD out the shooting range, you know, did this and all the rest of it. I mean, give me a break. So I'm done talking about that because we got so much news on the situation in Orlando. Hillary saying she's coming after our guns, all the rest of it. Briefly, I'm going to do my first ever Reddit Ask Me Anything tonight, 6 to 8 o'clock. There'll be a video feed free for everybody at Infowars.com/AMA. We'll also put it up on Infowars.com/show as an event video, so you can't miss it. But Infowars.com/AMA for Ask Me Anything. And we'll send out a link to everybody that's in the Infowars Insider, everybody that follows us on the email, Infowars.com/newsletter to put in your email, and we'll send you those video links, exclusive articles, promo codes, and more when you sign up for Infowars.com/newsletter. But tonight, Ask Me Anything for 2 hours, commercial-free, special guest, and more, 6 to 8. And it'll run directly up against Infowars Nightly News because we're not in competition with each other. By the way, the graphic I had up on screen earlier said AMA was tomorrow, my Ask Me Anything. No, it's today. Okay, so I just want everybody to know that the Ask Me Anything is today, Tuesday, 6 o'clock Central Time, Infowars.com/AMA. Now, I know I said that on air too, so that's good. Everybody knows that. Tuesday. Today is Tuesday. That's when we're going to be doing it. So, I want to play this Donald Trump clip here. This is Donald Trump yesterday, and then the Washington Post came out and said that he was implying Obama did it. No, the implication is that Obama just doesn't care and has some other plan, like coming after our guns. That's what Donald Trump is saying. Here's the clip.
What about the military strike? Where would you strike overseas?
I'd strike, well, you know, they know. We have generals, and I've been with them, and I've talked to them. We have generals that feel we can win this thing so fast and so strong, but we have to be furious for a short period of time, and we're not doing it. I mean, I said go after the oil, hit the oil. They announce when they're going to hit the oil because they want the people to leave their trucks. I mean, the whole thing is so ridiculous. Can you imagine General Patton saying, please get out of your trucks because we're going to start dropping bombs in 1 hour? This is the way we fight.
Donald Trump,
we're led by a fool.
So you're saying
we're led by a man that either is not tough, not smart, or he's got something else in mind. And the something else in mind, you know, people can't believe it. People cannot they cannot believe that President Obama is acting the way he acts and can't even mention the words radical Islamic terrorism. There's something going on. It's inconceivable. Right. There's something going on. Well, the man has no clue. He doesn't know what he's doing. And Hillary Clinton is going to be worse than him. Right. She wants to increase people coming into our country from the areas I'm talking about by 500%.
All right. And now he's saying, because the Washington Post came out and said that he was saying Obama was behind the Orlando attack, that he's pulled their press credentials. Because that's not what he said. He's kind of having his cake and eating it too, though. What he's saying is we're being soft on Islamic terror. We're not going after where they're actually based. We're not going after their funding. And so Obama's the biggest fool in the world, or something else is going on. And that is they're letting Islamic State come in and take over Syria. That's been declassified. That's been in the news for over a year. You heard it here first 4 or 5 years ago. So that's what's going on. And that's what he's saying. They tailor that, though, to say that he's saying Orlando was basically run by Obama. And that's not what Donald Trump said. Now, I will say that criminal elements of our government opening the borders up, allowing these radicalizers in, allowing these imams in, who weren't born here, to come in and hype up native-born people, first generation like this Afghan, clearly is contributing to it. So if Obama and Hillary want to point their finger at the American people and say that it's our fault that all this is going on and that gun owners are to blame and all the rest of this bull, then clearly we can say you are to blame by that yardstick, because gun owners have nothing to do with this. You are the people at the State Department and the Justice Department that have been coddling these imams, his very imam at his very mosque, saying, kill the gays, kill the homosexuals. I mean, it's crazy. You can have this guy running around with his imam and his daddy saying, kill the homosexuals. He's hanging around over at the gay bar feeling guilty about it. So he decides to go to Saudi Arabia, get radicalized, and then come back and kill people. And we've got a psychiatrist joining us, Dr. Steve Pachenik, not just an assassin and the whole nine yards, to break all this down and get his take on it coming up in the next hour. So you do not want to miss that information. And then Dr. Bill Warner was on with us for the first time ever just last week, but we're having him back on today because he predicted that this jihad attacks were about to start and about to be increasing. So he'll be joining us. We'll have open phones when both gentlemen are on with us today. All right, I'm going to settle down now, and I'm going to try to come back, and because I get really mad about this mass shooting. I get really mad when they're trying to guilt yours truly and all of you out there and blame us and tell us that we collectively are to blame when all of... Oh, I forgot the stabbing attack killing people with a jihadi in France today. I mean, there's so much of it, I can't even keep track of it. And it was somebody the guy knew and was friends with. What is it about these guys? They pick people they know that they think are wimpy. It's just like even more evil, though. They kill people they know. This guy's running around on gay apps, then he goes and kills them. Ladies and gentlemen, it is so hard for me to deal with to watch the evil people in our controlled corporate media and their stupid domesticated camp followers all over the news just blaming gun owners, blaming conservatives, blaming American gun culture for a man who's pledged allegiance to ISIS, a man who had a gun license and worked as a contractor for one of the biggest mercenary companies out there, a man who was on gay apps, a guy that trafficked the bar and was there basically stalking his prey. And we have imams on TV lecturing us about don't sensationalize this, and this isn't Islam. Look at what's happening in Islamic countries all over the world. They're running around killing each other 24/7, even where they have gun bans in some countries. Europe brings in 5 million of them in the last 3 years. We bring in massive numbers. Donald Trump says we're going to have more attacks. And then when he's proven right, the media attacks him. This is truly the death of common sense. And then his brother is involved in bringing in refugees and has Homeland Security contracts. They're not even vetted. They make all this money off of it. And people at his work said he was making threats that he was going to carry out terror attacks and had connections to terror groups. And the FBI wasn't allowed to go after him by Hillary Clinton and the State Department. WorldNet Daily has the FBI and Secret Service whistleblowers. They're coming on the show in the next few days. They broke the news Sunday. No coverage. We wrote about their article, Kit Daniels did. Hillary Clinton's State Department blocked investigation into Orlando shooter's mosque. Drudge links to it, but still, it gets over a million people that read it in the last 24 hours, but no mainstream media coverage because there's a blackout. Just like with Roger Stone. Banned on MSNBC. Banned on CNN, banned in all these publications. And they say he's banned because he's too effective. And they tell him, even when he's about to go on Newsmax or other channels, don't bring up the rape. But there's one guy they can't censor. That's Donald Trump. When he goes on Fox, he brings up the rape word. They say, oh, be nice, Donald. That's how you're going to beat Hillary. No, taking the gloves off, which he's done, is how he's going to do it. So I want to say happy birthday to Donald Trump, 70 years old. Today, I'm told. We'll ask Roger if that's accurate. And I want to say congratulations for not backing down, for being hardcore, and for bringing up the rape, and bringing up the abuse, and bringing up the narcotics trafficking, and bringing up all the dead bodies, and bringing up Vince Foster, and bringing up all the things that are happening. And pointing out that crooked Hillary is a nightmare. So let's all tweet, happy birthday at Real Donald Trump. Hero born on Flag Day. Well, all I know is it's very exciting to know that I bet on the right pony over a year ago. And I don't mean that he'll even win. I think he will. That we bet on the right pony for the guy that just gets more hardcore and more stalwart as he goes. So how is the mainstream media going to spin this? Trump says there will be more San Bernardino's shootings. There will be more Brussels, Belgium attacks. And then people congratulate him on being accurate, trying to defend America. He says, thank you for congratulating me. And they go, oh, he's congratulating himself. as if he was involved in the shooting. See, now it's his fault. Well, Roger Stone joins us to talk about this and to also talk about his article from Breitbart.com. It's time America got some answers about Huma Abedin, who a lot of experts we've had on believe is a Saudi Arabian spy. And she has all the cutouts, all the backgrounds. Why is the White House standing down on Islamic terror? Trump comes out and says he's the biggest moron, the biggest fool ever, or he knows something we don't know. He's got another agenda. That's backing ISIS to take over the Middle East, which has been documented. They spin it and say, he says, oh, Orlando's what he meant. No, that's not what he was talking about. He's talking about bombing the trucks, the oil trucks. Why are you giving them warnings? Why are you letting them get to shelter? Why are you aiding and abetting them? Well, we know. Cy Hirsch went public 6 months ago on my show and said, you were correct. Your guests were correct. For 5 years, our government's been ordered to back al-Qaeda and now ISIS in Syria. And our military has told Obama they're not going to be part of it. Obama, folks, is allied with radical Islam. And Roger Stone is here, the consummate Trump insider, StoneZone.com, to talk about it with us. Roger, thanks for coming on. A lot is happening. Trump is just surging in the polls. But let's talk all things Trump. But first off, this Hillary's girlfriend, Abedin, and this whole Saudi connection and the rest of it, I think ties together. Do you think I'm on the trail of the bloodhound here, or am I off target?
These are entirely related issues. What's happened in the last several days, as you know, has validated the very premise of Donald Trump's campaign, and that being that we need to seal our borders. We need an aggressive plan to destroy ISIS. Hillary Clinton, in truth, created ISIS. It was the policies of Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, and yes, George W. Bush, that both created ISIS and have armed ISIS. Now, ISIS is our worst enemy, and the problem has come to our shores. So I think Trump's campaign theme has been entirely validated. While we're at it, I have written a very provocative piece, which I knew would be provocative, in which I lay out the facts regarding the chic and exotic and well-connected Huma Abedin, the right-hand henchwoman of Hillary Clinton. She and her family, through her academic career, through her parents' various connections, are very clearly tied to groups that funded bin Laden. I mean, I pose really three questions. Now, yesterday, Keith Olbermann attacked me, David Brock attacked me, a spokesman for Hillary attacked me, and even Huma herself responded. I just would like the American people to hear Hillary answer three simple questions. What is Huma's relationship with Abdul Omar Nassif, who is the radical who employed both of her parents and her brothers, who founded the Muslim World League, but more importantly, founded the Rabitha Trust? The Rabitha Trust was declared by the Bush administration to be a terror organization and a partial funding of the activities of bin Laden. This is not conjecture. Why, after 9/11, wasn't this pointed out? Radical Muslim connections of Huma Abedin ever got a top security clearance? Now, I understand she's beautiful, and I understand she's exotic, and I understand she's socially well-connected, and I understand she is the wife of Congressman Carlos Danger, Anthony Weiner, but she tweeted yesterday in response to my piece, one can be a Muslim and a loyal American. Yes, one can. This has nothing to do with being a Muslim. It has to do with being affiliated.
And again, we're having Mr. Stone, hold on one moment. Your Skype's breaking up just a bit. I want you to be able to recalibrate it and rejoin with us here. And we're also putting on screen for TV.
So the facts are there for
we're going to need to disconnect him for a moment, please, so that that doesn't happen. He's lost his audio feed from us to him. So we need to reconnect with Roger Stone. Thank you. Now, continuing. I'm going to calm down right now. I'm having some anger issues today, okay? But they're launching the Tet Offensive. The globalists are making their move against our guns. There's no doubt they're going to put us into a Great Depression. There's no doubt their secret weapon is radical jihad. There's no doubt they hate the bitter clingers. There's no doubt that our country is run by pure scum, okay? So I'm fundamentally upset about this, and I am fundamentally just in general mad about the fact that we have traitors running our government and running our country that are now saying we're going to come after our guns. It makes me fundamentally want to throw up. Now, I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to play some clips, okay? Let's go ahead and look at these clips here. I'm going to tell folks which clips I want to pull up. There's a report here where Hillary Clinton says abortions are a constitutional right, but the right to bear arms isn't. So let's go ahead and play a short clip of that.
Thank you for being there for every woman in every state who has to miss work, drive hundreds of miles sometimes, endure cruel, medically unnecessary waiting periods, walk past angry protesters to exercise her constitutional right to safe and legal abortion.
Do you believe that their conclusion that an individual's right to bear arms is a constitutional right?
If it is a constitutional right, then it, like every other constitutional right, is subject to reasonable regulations. And what people have done with that decision is to take it as far as they possibly can and reject what has been our history from the very beginning of the Republic, where some of the earliest laws that were passed were about firearms. So I think it's important to recognize that reasonable people can say, as I do, responsible gun owners have a right. I have no objection to that. But the rest of the American public has a right to require certain kinds of regulatory responsible actions to protect everyone else.
Okay, so this guy had a Homeland Security clearance, was doing work bringing refugees in with his uncle, had a gun license, and the FBI had tried to stop him twice but was ordered to stand down by the Justice Department and the State Department that Hillary was running. Hillary's State Department blocked investigation to Orlando Killer's mosque. Further proof, Hillary funded the rise of ISIS. And then meanwhile, 20% of her campaign is from the Saudis alone, and her foundation got over $100 million from the Gulf states that lock women up and treat them worse than dogs. And then we have another one of these bizarre, narcissistic clowns that when he's not on the gay apps or whatever, he's going into a nightclub and killing 49 people. We have Roger Stone back, and he's written the articles. Roger Stone, it's time America got some answers about Huma Abedin. I mean, this is just crazy. Roger Stone, again, joining us now via phone. Roger, please continue.
You know, Alex, this is disappointing because I'm so damn handsome. I hate to do it this way, but in any event, to get back to where we were, I think you make exactly the point. Hillary and her husband have taken hundreds of millions of dollars from regimes that not only oppress women.
It's time to just arrest their asses. It's time to just freaking throw them in irons, man. What more do we have to put up from these people? And why are they allied with Islam? What freak show is this that we have these freaks running on? Roger, I'm sorry. I'm really getting fed up, okay?
But, Alex, the answer is an honest attorney general appointed by a president who puts the interests of the United States, not radical Islam and political correctness, first. You are not going to get an honest government from this administration. You are not going to get fair adjudication of the law from Loretta Lynch. I don't know. I feel badly for the FBI director, who's known as a man of integrity, a real by-the-book guy. He works for a president for whom the law does not matter. It is any manner of crimes. I mean, why is Huma Abedin allowed to triple dip, getting a full-time salary from the State Department, a full-time salary from Teneo Strategies, a lobby firm that represents many of those same oppressive regimes we're talking about?
Because in the politically correct freak zone of America, As long as you're some stupid protected group, you can commit any crimes you want, including funding ISIS, murdering 300,000 Christians in Syria.
Well, and in all honesty, the attacks on gays in Orlando puts a very significant crimp into the far left Democratic coalition. Frankly, my gay friends are worried about three things. One, their security. They don't want to go to a club or a public place and be killed by some radical Islamic maniac. Number two, my gay friends want jobs. They want opportunity. They want a strong country and a vibrant economy so they can do well, so they can adopt children, so they can have families, so they can get married. That's what my gay friends care about. And the number of gay Americans who are telling me they are for Trump because they believe he will protect gays and all Americans from the threat of Islamic terror.
Well, I mean, here's the bottom line. Explain the calculus to me. They're bringing in all these radicals. They're blocking the FBI from stopping them. The San Bernardino people going back and forth between Saudi Arabia, this freak, all these people. They know they're going to attack. They know that's only going to make Trump more popular. Why are they allowing this to happen?
Well, because I don't think they understand that. I think that this is an attempt to going back to Sidney Blumenthal's original strategy to maximize the turnout of the left. They see this as a numbers game. Particularly in those instances where they can vote illegals, which they on the left have always been adept at doing through the city machines and the other community organizations. So they aren't trying to appeal to anybody in the center. Unlike Bill Clinton, who tried to at least move the imagery of his party to the center and bring back white working class Democrats in the far west and south, Hillary has adopted the Obama strategy. Get every left-wing whack job and or minority voter out humanly possible and hope that you outnumber the other side. That's the strategy. So she is not going to call Islamic terrorism what it is, the fundamental danger of today, probably the greatest single challenge other than insolvency facing the country today.
It really does show their broken coalition strategy that they just want balkanization, but don't the Democrats get, they're going to have the albatross around their neck forever as sleeper cells pop off every month, every week for the next decade. And
But I don't think you understand how delusional they are. They think by Trump calling for closing our borders, building a wall, stepping up security, and crushing ISIS, they think that makes him look like a xenophobic right-wing maniac. They don't understand that that's...
You're right. They're in their own freak show echo chamber where they're trying to tell people you can't say mother or father because it's hurtful to people that don't have mother or fathers. You can't have dodgeball. You can't have Halloween parties because costumes might be hurtful. This is a cult.
This is epic. I mean, yesterday David Brock says in his Twitter feed, Huma Abedin is a fine public servant, which is more than I can say for Roger Stone. Well, wait a minute. Public servant would imply she was only on the taxpayers' payroll. In fact, she was getting paid by the Teneo lobbying group and the Clinton Foundation, triple dipping. So I don't know what he's talking about. And then Keith Olbermann said, how does it feel to have worked your whole life in politics and now being a flying monkey for Donald Trump? To which I respond, at least I can keep a job.
Well said. I mean, all they do is attack us when we're just saying common sense stuff.
But here's the point, though, Alex. They can't refute the facts. Huma's ties to the most radical brand of Islam through her parents, through her brothers, through Nashif, are all indisputable. They are indisputable, and they have been certified by the U.S. government. So rather than argue with the facts, they attack the person who delivers the facts. Oh, he's a conspiracy theorist. Well, really? What conspiracy sealed the 28 pages of the congressional inquiry into what
That's
really
right.
happened?
Well, bottom line, Hillary Clinton's girlfriend is a Saudi spy. Is that the headline?
I don't know whether she is Hillary's handler, whether she's an asset. Well, I mean, you don't know how deep it goes.
Well, all I know is they stay in the same bedroom together when they travel.
There is evidence that is accurate. But again, the left wants to say, oh,
why couldn't Hillary get a good-looking girlfriend? I mean, why doesn't she look like a Marilyn Monroe or something? This woman looks
looks
like Bin Laden.
I think that Huma is stunning. If you go to my 2015 Stone Zone best and worst dressed list, which I do every January, a 10-year tradition, which I adopted from Mr. Blackwell. You'll find her on my list. She looks great whether she's going to a UN cocktail party or a Muslim brother bomb making.
Well, I'm not, and I shouldn't be doing low blows against Hillary's girlfriend. I'm just baiting the media into picking this up. But hey, let's shift gears, Roger Stone, for a moment, because they're obviously not going to be able to block this forever. It's coming out. How are things really going for the campaign? I mean, you always give us the straight shot. How is Team Trump doing?
I think Monday may have been the best day the Trump campaign has to date, in the sense that he is back to dominating the dialogue. This election is going to be decided largely on the question of who can deal with domestic terrorists who plan to kill many, many people between now and the election day and after. If you believe Hillary Clinton is better suited to handle that problem, then you should vote for her. On the other hand, Trump is back on his strong suit. This has validated his central argument that we need to secure our borders. So I think he's back on offense. The major speech on the Clintons' corruption, which was scheduled for Monday, is still in the works, as I understand it, and it will be a devastating narrative. The foibles of the Clinton Foundation and the epic corruption there, in which foreign nations are paying, like Russia, like China, like Saudis, are paying for favors and preferential treatment, while it has gotten some good coverage from the New York Times, largely the mainstream media has sought to ignore it.
Sure. So the question is the establishment going to let a foreign multinational coup take place of America? Because we will be fully conquered if Hillary, who's totally blackmailed, gets into power, blackmailed by all these disparate interests that have, you know, treated her, you know, like a vending machine where they put money in and get out of it what they want. It is truly, truly, truly outrageous. And it does show their disconnect. Hillary, whose State Department protected this very person, this monster, now blaming the Second Amendment. I think they've really miscalculated. What do you think, Roger Stone?
Well, I mean, what's really amazing is if Al Capone were alive today, he would be in awe at what they have built at the Clinton Foundation. I mean, this is an international pay-for-play scheme. It is the largest single money laundering operation in U.S. history. And the Clintons have taken millions of dollars both through the foundation and through their phony global initiative and through their phony speeches directly to their pockets, hundreds of millions of dollars of people buying decisions in Washington. I look forward to a time when Hillary, who says she is an advocate for women, I'd like to hear from the women of Libya. How have they fared under the regime change there that was fought?
And the same thing in Syria. Roger Stone, I always appreciate your time. In closing, what do you make of this whole Washington Post situation where Trump says they're kicked off the campaign? I mean, that's fine with me because they're obviously globalist operatives in many ways. But at the same time, I mean, he's talking about, hey, you know, we should have bombed the trucks. We shouldn't give them an hour's notice. You know, either Obama's a fool or he's got another agenda. Clearly, he's not talking about the Orlando shooting there. He's saying Obama is, you know, has the gloves on when it comes to fighting ISIS. Well, we know that. But I mean, what is Trump so mad about? The fact they tried to misrepresent it as Orlando?
The Washington Post is the single most dishonest publication in the history of American journalism. They were wrong about Watergate. They were wrong about Iran-Contra. They were wrong about the Iraq War. And they're wrong about the current situation. I have a piece that I will be publishing shortly, a 5,000-word piece called The Lies of Bob Woodward. And I trace how he is a pathological liar who has lied about every major historical event in his repertorial career.
So, well, sure, isn't he really just a naval intelligence front?
I say bravo, and someplace, believe me, someplace... Dick Nixon is giving the thumbs up over Trump's trashing of the Washington Post.
Well, I was about to say, it's clearly a foreign intelligence cutout. I mean, Bilderberg Group basically runs it. They admit that.
Well, it has always had a traditional close ties to the Central Intelligence Agency. Socially, the Grahams mixed with Angleton and Meyer, and that's their social set. It is interesting that shortly after the death of John F. Kennedy, former President Harry Truman wrote an op-ed piece in which he said that approving the formation of the CIA was the greatest mistake he made as president, that it had become a rogue government unto itself. That ran for one edition, and then it was spiked by the publishers at the request.
That's right, and of course the CIA itself is basically a foreign intelligence group set up by the British. I'm not saying the British run us, but it's like a multinational combine. And, of course, your books break that down. They're all available at InfoWarsStore.com and StoneZone.com. Roger, thank you for the update. I look forward to having you on very soon.
Alex, great to be with you as always.
There goes Roger Stone with the latest information. Before I go any further, I'm doing the first Ask Me Anything on Reddit tonight, 6 to 8 o'clock Central. And we'll have that feed up. You can also watch the nightly news, and there'll be the feed of the daytime show. We're just spewing media out of the stratosphere here. You can ask me anything at 6 p.m. tonight. The feed will be at Infowars.com/AMA. That's right. Infowars.com/AMA. You can see the graphic there. It says Infowars.com/show, because there'll also be a feed there. And we'll have a feed up on the YouTube channel, Real Alex Jones. So you'll find the feeds. The best thing to do is sign up at Infowars.com/newsletter. And we will send you any special event, links and feeds and showtime. So it's easy to find it right in your email, Infowars.com/newsletter. I'm Alex Jones. We'll be right back with the second hour. We just talked to Roger Stone about Hillary Clinton's girlfriend. And look, I'm not even mad she's got a girlfriend that's a operative of the Saudis. It's that she's an operative of the Saudis. And that our country is overrun by foreign interest. And the political class has basically legalized, by fiat at the top, selling us out to anybody and everybody. It's kind of like the big mega banks decided 20 years ago under Clinton to change the laws. The Republicans went along with it, to where they could sell the same house's mortgage twice. And once they did that, within a few months, they said, how about we sell it three times? How about five times? How about 10 times? How about 20 times? How about 30 times? In some cases, we look this up, your home mortgage was sold to investors more than 100 times. This is the con artist cult that we have running things that, used to, they cared if nuclear reactors were leaking. They cared. They tried to stop them from that. Used to, they closed reactors after about 25, 30 years. Now they just leave them open and just say, we're not even going to do safety upgrades and stuff. We're just going to let them leak and blow up. And you say, but why? They go, we make more money. And you say, but there won't be any planet left. If you, it'll be uninhabitable. And they just look at you and just giggle and snicker. And all they care about is going to country clubs and acting rich and flying around on helicopters and wearing the newest, finest French and Italian dresses. Seriously. They don't care about hypocrisy, where Schmidt, the head of Google, has his girlfriends wear hoods over their heads, like Michael Jackson would do to his adopted kids, because he wants them to have privacy. But then he says, you're dumb if you think you have any privacy and shouldn't do anything on the internet. You don't want to be known publicly. This is after decades of him telling us it was all private while they suckered us in. You people are delusional megalomaniacs. And something else has happened. The attention span of most people's gone down to about 7 seconds. That of a goldfish. And I don't think there'll be any human society left in 10 years. I think you're going to start just seeing people just not even get out of bed soon. And then just, no one has memories. No, most people don't. There are a lot of folks that still are competent and are professional and have brains. But I'm telling you, people, there's so much stimuli and so much stuff that just in general, stuff is breaking down right now. Things are breaking down right now. And God help us is all I can say. God help us. Because we have crazy people running things. I mean, we have top generals all over Fox News and CNN saying, let's just go ahead and attack Russia. Let's go ahead and kill hundreds of thousands of them and put them in body bags. That'll teach them to submit to us when you're up on their border attacking them. No, killing hundreds of thousands of people will get us in a giant nuclear war, dumbass. It won't teach the Russians anything, you stupid moron. If you knew any history or common sense, you'd know that. But you know that. You'd rather sit up there in your suit with a bunch of sycophants and be the national security advisor to Fox News. Oh, General, tell us how to get tough. Tell us how to end the world, you stupid, stupid, bloated maggot. You people don't have souls, I'm telling you right now. People like that are gone. You're gone. You're an enemy of humanity. You're an enemy of progress. You're an enemy of the species, and you're dog crap. Dr. Steve Pachinik is a frequent guest of ours. He's been coming on since 2002. He's been exposing the fact that criminal elements of multinational conglomerates are working with radical Islam, Saudi Arabia, and others to bring in a police state in the West. And, of course, the payoff to Saudi Arabia is they get to control the Middle East. They get to spread their form of Wahhabism across the board. Now, Dr. Pachinik is probably one of the leading experts on what's really happening in the Middle East. He successfully, as the head of PSYOPs for the White House at the Camp David Accords, actually got the only effective peace treaty in the Middle East that held for any amount of time. And, of course, the leader of Egypt was later assassinated by a jihadist to basically unseat all of that. And he can talk about Arabist, who they are. He can talk about the different players. And he'll really give you a straight shot on this. But here's what I want to ask him. We have this gentleman and others and their families being brought into the country. We have 5 million, quote, refugees in Europe. It's in the hundreds of thousands here. They're keeping those numbers secret. They know there's going to be certain amounts of them that are being radicalized by ISIS propaganda that is just the new name for Al-Qaeda. They're going to attack. And when they do attack, the government that brought them in should get the blame. But if there is a victory over common sense, instead they'll just say, we've got to have political correctness laws, hate speech laws, that you can't criticize Islam. You're causing them to attack. That's what Europe's already done. Civil emergency in Germany and other areas. France, you name it. Sweden. But I just don't see that flying here in the United States. It's really waking up gun owners. Gun sales are now at record levels yet again. Smith & Wesson and others have raised prices today. A lot of liberals are going out buying guns. The homosexual community is really waking up that they were targeted by this guy who reportedly didn't shoot black people. He said, I have no, quote, problem with blacks. Just bizarre behavior. Now we learned he was on these gay dating apps, The Guardian's reporting, and that he went to the gay club a lot. That's how he got in so easily. Then he worked for this security company with ties to the CIA. Now, I want to be clear. When something's a false flag, we expose it. This is more of a stand down in that they brought these folks in. The FBI knew. They were told to stand down by the State Department of all people. Whistleblowers have gone public. Just like San Bernardino, the FBI was ordered to stand down 2 years before when these people were going back and forth to Saudi Arabia. This guy did this too, this Matin. So why is Obama so paralyzed on radical Islam? Why are they bringing in so many of these people? Who is Huma Abedin? The word is she's like a Saudi operative. Hillary's girlfriend. Is the White House blackmailed by Saudi Arabia? Or are they just bought off by him? We have video Saturday. General Petraeus walks out of Bilderberg. Reporters walk up and he runs from them. And our reporters chase him through the streets of Dresden. We're going to play that footage today. It's up on Infowars.com. Peter Thiel got cornered, had to answer questions. So a lot of big things are happening, and Petraeus is getting all this money from the Saudis now. The Saudis are making a major move. Why is Europe bringing in 5 million people, 80% of military-age men? We had a stabbing today by a jihadist pledging allegiance in France to ISIS. This guy's brother-in-law is involved with Obama bringing the refugees in. Suddenly, in Austin, Texas, downtown or north or south, all over, there are women with burqas, not just hijabs everywhere. I mean, where I live, I'm seeing women in full Saudi Arabian slave outfits. It's freaking me out. So I don't want the Dick Cheney clash of civilizations, but what do I do once they've stirred up the Middle East, made it fail, put radicals in, they're bringing them into attack, and they think they're going to blame gun owners and veterans for the deaths? No, we're going to blame Hillary Clinton and Obama and the globalists and the neocons. So I want to ask Dr. Pachinik where he thinks all this is going. I know he was coming on today to talk about a book he wrote about his mother, but he wants to do that another time, so we'll do that in a few weeks. But it's an interesting story. It's very political as well. But Dr. Pechenik obviously has been involved all the world special operations. One of the guys with General Boykin and others that founded Delta Force. I'm not going to go over his whole background. He's a psychiatrist and a medical doctor. And he can speak to the psychology of all of this. And I don't know his views yet on it. We're going to find out. I respect him. I just want to get him on and get his views right now. Dr. Pechenik, thanks for joining us. In the 4 minutes till break, what do you think really happened here? And what does this signify? And again, as I asked, is Obama blackmailed? Is he a closet Muslim? I know they're trying to have a clash of civilizations. Are the globalists double-crossing the West? And are they deciding to go Islamic long-term? What's happening?
What's really happening is we have a very dysfunctional intelligence system, in particular the FBI and the CIA. Let me go over this. Since 9/11, you have to remember that both the CIA, the FBI, military intelligence, and an entire group of security apparatuses joined in the stand down false flag. Nothing has really changed. Obama was brought in, as I said to you, and nobody believed it. Obama, Clinton, Bush Jr., Bush Sr. by the CIA. Then they're put into the political arena where they're either Republican.
So really we're talking about the incompetency of the CIA coup we've had since 1963?
Yeah, in this case, it's the FBI. Let me go backwards and give you some basic points that should have been brought up, not by you. I always appreciate being on your show, but by people in general. 2 days ago, I wrote a blog which said very clearly that Mateen was radicalized in his home. Number one, he was a homosexual. It was so obvious to me as a psychiatrist. It was obvious, and it should have been obvious to the FBI and anybody who interrogated him for 7 months or 10 months, that he was a closeted homosexual who wasn't closeted. Now, why is this important? Because he went out for 150 miles, went to that club several times, which I suspected was true, and in fact killed the very people to which he identified. Now, what makes that interesting in the Muslim religion is that Islam denies the importance and legitimacy of the gay homosexual. But on the other hand, they practice homosexuality. So you have this paradox in all of the Arab world where on the one hand, they will stone women and they will stone men who commit homosexual acts. But the very essence of Islam and bonding of the men is homosexual. But they don't call it that. They call it attraction and bonding of brotherhood. They use other words for it. So, in fact, what you've seen is the very paradox of Islam, and it should have been brought out by the intelligence community, by the FBI, and it was obvious. Secondly, he was radicalized at home. He was radicalized by a father who was a mushahideen. In fact, his father, who I wrote about, is named Sadiq Mir Mateen. He's an Afghani mushahideen who was brought in by the CIA. The FBI knew about it. He has a weekly radio show where he goes in full military regalia as a mushahideen. That means as a Sunni Afghani who bemoans the fact that Pakistan is attacking Afghanistan. Now, if the FBI didn't know that, this is pathetic. Because, in fact, the father lied when he said, I don't know anything about my son. It never occurred.
All right, Dr. Pechenik, stay there. I'm going to come back and give you the floor. And by the way, you did write this 2 days ago. It's all turned out to be dead on accurate.
Correct.
We're going to take your article, post it to Infowars.com, and say,
no problem.
Headline like, you know, psychiatrist accurately predicted that Orlando shooter was a homosexual radicalized at home. We're going to push that headline out, pointing out that it was first published actually on Sunday. So we're talking basically 2.5-3 days ago. Dr. Pechenik knows his stuff. Top psych warfare expert. Dr. Steve Pechenik, again, is retired, but he's one of the top former experts for the Pentagon, the State Department, you name it, on psychological operations with foreign governments, overthrow of governments, stabilization of governments, you name it. And he's seen it all, folks. And the info he's given us over the years has always been so accurate, especially long term. I personally am so upset about all these radical Muslims they're bringing in. They're protecting, they're allowing to attack. They bring in the, you know, the latest groups. They then radicalize the last group that was already here. And a lot of this, from my own just lay psychology studying, and they don't feel wanted. They don't feel like they're part of the culture. They're very conflicted. You're mixing folks from radical Orthodox Islamic countries with one of the wildest laissez-faire decadent societies out there. I don't agree with all the decadence. I don't endorse it, but in a free society, you have to let it operate. Well, you bring people in where daddy's got a radio show saying kill the gays, and your imam says kill the gays, and you're sneaking off to the gay nightclub, and then finally you have a breakdown and want to commit suicide by cop. And plus, Islamic State saying go out and kill, it's a mentally ill mindset. I mean, this just all fits, from my own study of Islam, the massive amount of homosexuality and pedophilia. That's what I talked about yesterday, and they had a bunch of newspapers attack me. But here is U.S. government top psychiatrist that helped write the Camp David Accords, okay? He's telling you the same thing I told you, but I'm just a layperson that's done basic research. Dr. Pechenik, this is a short segment, long segment coming up, but is my statement there somewhat accurate that it's a culture shock as well for these people?
Well, there's no question of bringing in Muslims in general is a culture shock, but we have to differentiate. The very important objective here is one of the reasons why we have gone and opened up Iran, which was a very important strategic move, was to literally neutralize Saudi Arabia, UAE, and the Emirates and Kuwait, because they had for a long time under the CIA, under our military support, been extruding out all of these terrorist groups. So Iran, in effect, which is a Shiite country, does not have the same demonstration or the same profile as you have in the Sunnis. The Shiites have been doing the major part of our war in Syria against the Sunnis in Yemen, and they have been taking the bulwark of this entire war. Now, with all due respect, I want to put in perspective, number one, Hezbollah, which was considered a terrorist group, comes out of Lebanon. These are the young men who fight literally 10 minutes from their house. Imagine going from Austin 10 minutes out and are fighting ISIS hand-to-hand combat without the support that we give them. At the same time, the Kurds, who have been suppressed by the Sunnis and the Saudis, are fighting. So you can't make a generalized statement.
No, I totally understand. We're talking about Wahhabist, Saudi Arabia, ISIS.
I understand, but we have to appreciate that there are forces now in play where our special forces like Kennedy go in and help out our forces in Iraq and Syria. And in fact, the intelligence reports, and unfortunately it's not coming forth to the public, it shows that we're degrading ISIS. This was not an ISIS-inspired entity, because if you give ISIS that credit and legitimacy, we're really putting ISIS up there, when in fact it's a pathetic organization that is no longer viable.
I understand. So is that why Saudi Arabia is freaking out and
yes,
staging terror?
Saudi Arabia is freaking out for many reasons. Number one, the king who's in charge has to put a prince who's 30 years old, totally incompetent, totally untutored, who's starting a war in Yemen, doesn't know what to do. They have 50% unemployment among their youth. They can't pump out any oil. They had to do an IPO on their oil that was there. Namely, they have to commoditize the little oil they have, and they have failed as an entity.
So we're seeing the fall of the House of Saud, potentially?
Correctly. You're seeing the fall of the House of Saud, of Qatar, Kuwait, UAE. All of those countries created by the British and the French are being destroyed. And that's happening as a result of American power,
And that's why we've seen the French and NATO double-crossing, trying to back ISIS?
Well, the truth of ISIS is that Syria and Russia, while they're fighting them, is also supplying them. Always remember that in the war of anything, we both supply the people and we fight them. It's never one or the other. Remember 9/11. We supported
sure, it's full spectrum.
These people, and then we fought against them.
Sure, well, that's pretty much what I figured is going on here. But then I want to break down the players,
sure,
the different power blocks with Dr. Pechenik.
Absolutely, yeah.
And get more into this whole jihad Saudi Arabia culture. Do we expect more frequent attacks? What culturally comes out of that? Dr. Pechenik's our guest. You heard Dr. Pechenik mention Tim Kennedy, who is one of the most famous, unfamous soldiers. He's known for the UFC fighting. People think he's even out of the military. He's not out of the military. And I'll just leave it at that. And let's just say we've got some really good reporters on the ground around the world. And I'm just amazed at how patriotic and awake the military is. I've got to say, it's not a cliche. It just tends to be the Army over and over again that exposes 9/11, that exposed Benghazi, that's exposing what's happening in Orlando. By the way, Joe Biggs has huge breaking news. Let's try to get Joe Biggs on at about 45 after with that breaking news directly from the groups on the ground in Orlando. They're looking at accomplices, all right? Well, they found it. And we're going to break it here, all right? But I'm going to be honest with you. I have pretty good self-control. I'm on the air 300-plus days a year. I'm just so upset in general by all the illogic and corruption and things I'm seeing and Hillary Clinton getting away with all these crimes that I physically got so angry last hour I could hardly be on air. And I guess I got to ask Dr. Pacinic, who's a psychiatrist, that phenomenon, how to calm down from that. Because I've had one cup of coffee today. I'm flying. I'm speeding right now. Like I'm on methamphetamine, and I'm not. And it's just the climate. And every time I feel like this historically, you know, I have a good spider sense. Everybody has it, a sixth sense. And I just see things lining up politically, economically, in a very, very dangerous way. And I know that there are actually good forces in our government that are trying to countermand the bad forces. And I'd always been told those forces were there. And of course, you know there's good and bad, but organized. And then we learned what Dr. Pacinic and Colonel Schaefer and countless others told us on air and off air in the last 5-6 years that our own military was blocking Al-Qaeda and then ISIS. That was a term to confuse the public, and that we were aiding the Russians to take them out. And even Cy Hirsch came on a few months ago and thanked our broadcast and said we were accurate and good sources and that we were correct. And then of course, Dr. Pacinic came on and talked about it. But I'm not here bragging about this. This is surreal. I don't want the responsibility of being this close to the center of all this. But then I sit around and I see a bunch of jellyfish that don't even know which end is up. And I mean men that are successful in business, in life. They've got high IQs, beautiful wives, great kids. But they don't think it's their responsibility to be involved or care. And I've psychoanalyzed myself. I am raging at men who are not being men. Because, man, I don't want to see us have a nuclear war. I don't want to see a Great Depression. I don't want to see things unravel. And let me tell you, it is unraveling. And our political class are the ones accelerating that. And there are good people in government, corporations, and private institutions that are trying to stop it. But I tell you, just I look at the whole continuum of it, and it's going in a very frightening direction. I know Pacinic's an optimist and, always can give us the incredible inside baseball on what the thinking is of groups that don't want to destroy the country and the world. But just at a gut level, absorbing it all, I've never been more angry. I'll just be, and it's controlled anger. It's controlled anger, but I am just sick dealing with it. And I'm going to get his view on that here in a moment. And then, speak of the devil, we have a clip shot 2 weeks ago by Tim Kennedy that wasn't going to be released till tomorrow, talking about political correctness will kill you. So that's coming up in the next hour. We're going to premiere that here because Tim Kennedy is working with InfoWars now. And a lot of other great folks will be working with InfoWars, taking the globalist on. But we're going to go back to Dr. Pacinic in a moment. I didn't plug anything in the first hour, which is crazy, and I skipped two ads. I got to stop doing that. We need you to buy the products and support this operation. We got the best products out there, whether it's nutraceuticals, non-GMO seeds, Hillary for Prison shirts, books, films, you name it, InfoWarsStore.com. Storable food. We have 20% off today on the ProPure family of water filters, including their incredible four-stage shower filter. You absorb so much crap out of the water, the glyphosates, the fluoride, the chlorine, the bromine, just all these chemicals. We have 20% off for a limited time on all Lexapure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. You get free shipping on orders $50 or more. You can also get 10% off on anything you get auto ship, like the vitamins and minerals and other supplements. But the Lexapure water filters are 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com for a limited time only. From the super high quality gravity fed Alexa Pure Pro water filtration systems to shower filters. Now is the time to stock up for the lowest prices. The Alexa Pure filtration system removes up to 99.9999% of bacteria, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones. You can even filter water from lakes, rivers, streams. Look, it's the best system out there. Alexa Pure is great, too. It's all pretty, basically, you know, they're apples and oranges. We have a bunch of great systems that cut basically everything down to 99.9999, whatever. Point is, this is 20% off right now. Great gravity-fed stainless steel systems. Check out the water filtration systems at InfoWarsStore.com. Take advantage of that today. And finally, I want to tell you about a separate sponsor, and that's SolutionsFromScience.com. Great preparedness, great survival stuff across the board. Really, really high-quality products. Discounted, and they only do sponsorship with us when they're doing a special. And they're running a special at solutionsfromscience.com on an amazing solar panel generator system and control panel. From solar power generators to survival gear and fertilizers, they're all available right now through Solutions from Science website. And Solutions from Science recently bought a surplus of solar power generators and are offering a discount to listeners who visit their website, solutionsfromscience.com. Or give them a call, 877-327-0365. That's 877-327-0365. Or again, go to InfoWarsLife.com to find all of the amazing products. It's not discounted anymore because it's almost sold out. But so what if it's not 20% off? Get it. Support the broadcast on harmful organism parasite cleanse, 120 caplets. It's 27 ingredients, all organic, all super clean. That's why it's so hard to... We've been sold out for 6 months because it's hard to get 27 ingredients to pass California standards. And we always shoot for that. But we now have it back in stock, but it's about to sell out. The special is over, but you can still get Living Defense at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. Now, again, Dr. Steve Pachinik is with us. I do want to have him back up if we can get him to come on and talk about it. He wanted to talk about terrorism today, about the book about his mother, A Voyage of Survival, Living in Love, Steve R. Pachinik, MD, PhD, because it'll really give you a bird's eye view on what people have gone through to try to get to America and, you know, why there's so many great people that have come to this nation that actually now are the bedrock of it. But find out about it and get the book at stevepachinik.com. But he did not want to get into that today. He wanted to talk about the issues that we were just getting into. So set the table for us. I know I do a disservice if I talk about the horrible pedophile hordes of the Wahhabists and associate that with the Shiites, who are a completely different group and are archenemies with the House of Saud. So let's spend some time on this. What you expect the fall of the House of Saud to look like, how far into it we are, what you expect their death throes to be. They're bragging they have nuclear weapons, which we know they've had for a while, according to my sources. Where does all this go? How do the Russians tie in with Syria? Dr. Pachinik.
Here's what we really have. Let's go back home. Number one, we have to ask for the resignation of James Comey and the FBI interrogators. He has been a disaster. I have been waiting for his indictment of Hillary, which was not a brain teaser. It was obvious. It was necessary. He did not perform accordingly. Therefore, his performance on this last interview or this last inability to figure out who Mateen was, which was basically a 101 class in interrogation and intelligence, should be the basis on which he resigns, Loretta Lynch resigns, and the FBI has to be reprimanded. From the very beginning, when I started the Hanafi Muslim hostage negotiation, the FBI has proven to be a disastrous, dysfunctional organization for which we have paid a tremendous amount of dollars, who was involved with Mueller and 9/11. I ask that the American public send...
Okay.
Dr. Pachinik, we lost your cell phone there for a moment. Are you there? He dropped. We need to get him back. He's always only on cell phone. It's a pretty clear cell phone. We are allied with radical Islam. The globalists are double-crossing us. The radical Islamists have bought off our politicians while the group that has done all this is on the verge of collapse. It's admitted that Saudi Arabia is tottering and teetering. They had to borrow $10 billion last month to pay their bills. I mean, these loons are completely spoiled rotten. They're completely disconnected from reality. And then they're out there funding ISIS to run around and tell everybody to go out and jihad and kill. And you've got this guy from Afghanistan radicalized by his father, and we did cover that by Sunday, and by his family, and by his imam saying kill homosexuals. And then Obama says this isn't Islam. And notice how Dr. Pechenik points out the bizarreness, where homosexuality is generally 2 to 3% of the population in the West. We're talking 20, 30% in Islam, in Wahhabist Islam. And the slave trading and just all of it, it is just so crazy that it is the most barbarous, over-the-top civilization anyone has ever seen, other than maybe North Korea. And they just execute and kill whoever they want. And then all over my Facebook and Twitter, there's rainbow flags getting posted going, Alex, you're a homophobe. You gun owners are going to get it and all this stuff. It's just the idiocy. It blows my mind completely that this is going on. And it really frustrates me. Dr. Pechenik, your phone cut out. You were getting into the details here about the situation with Saudi Arabia.
FBI has to go down. It has to be reprimanded. It has to be totally reorganized. It has to be thrown out. Comey has to leave. The other individuals within the FBI and the senior levels must be fired. Obama cannot do it. He is a weak president. I said it from very the day he began that he was a CIA package that came in through his mother, his grandparents, and that's the CIA bringing in. The CIA has to be held accountable. It, too, has to be put in place. If Mike Flynn comes in, General Flynn comes in, who might be the DNI, Director of National Intelligence under Trump, we might put it under control. But let me get to the issue that you were upset about, to Petraeus. General Petraeus has unfortunately been a very poor general and really did not stand up for much of what we thought as Americans, as military officers, and as intelligence officers. He was specifically placed in there by me and others as the director of the CIA to have military command and control of a civilian entity that really is out of control. Unfortunately, Petraeus betrayed us by having given 8 of his books to his honey-trapped individual, the woman who did the biography, and Obama had the information on him. So he's weak. He failed, and in fact, he was discredited. I hope nobody really pays any more attention, but what happens in the system is they promote him up, and they give him the 4 stars when he's really done very little. He was shot by his own friend on a gun range, and he was a terrible general and a terrible DCI. That's his legacy. The point of fact is we continued, and the reason why your good reviewer or reporter found him scared is that he is a scared individual. He went through and went up the political ranks. Now we get to the real problem. The real problem is we need a leader who can, in fact, change and redirect our entire government away from what it's been, dysfunctional, incapable of really doing anything, and really destroying our own people. The 9/11 did not go away. These are all of the overshoots of what happens when a government destroys its own people. In turn, that's why I believed we had the right to arm ourselves, we had the right to form militias, we had the right to do what we need to do in order to neutralize an illegal, a totally illegitimate government. And I've said it from day one. Although you got very angry on me, I've said it from the very beginning that we need a political and possibly military solution that comes from the people and possibly our own military.
Well, clearly we've already had a coup by foreign special interest and multinationals through the CIA and the National Security Act by the 70s and 80s. They were able to take over.
Then we need a counter coup, my friend. What I've been asking for since 9/11 is the Bush family has to be held accountable and the Clintons. What came forth? We had the Bush family and their representatives, the Rubios, the Ted Cruzes, and all of that. We got rid of them through a man called Trump. The Clintons have not been ridden, and they have.
Well, let's get your take on Trump, because I've been told by folks very close to Trump, and we've talked to Trump, obviously, on air and off air. I'll just leave it at that, that Trump, quote, knows everything, quote, everything,
And Trump knows everything, but I'm concerned that he's being co-opted by many of the regular routine Republicans. I would not have put in Manafort or a whole bunch of these guys who make a living by going around and lobbying other Republicans. I don't think Trump needs it. I think his own instincts were very good. He worked off of his instincts. And honestly, many of his advisors are just the retreads of people who worked for Dole, who worked for Ben Carson and others.
Well, I know they do. I know that, but they admit they were wrong and part of the CIA takeover and actually say they want to overthrow that.
But that's not the issue. The issue is, are they effective? And in my mind, they're not really that effective. Roger Stone is. There are others who were closer to Trump. Corey Lengowski was very effective. But once you dilute out that ability, once you have to have him control a massive group of Republicans who need to fund them, we're getting into trouble again. And that's why I'm asking the American people to be prepared for what may be a major confrontation with another corrupt government, and that is the Clintons, because I am not sure that Trump can make it through. Once he has to depend on the good graces of other Republicans and funding from major Republican entities, they're going to ask much from him. And I had believed that he should have had self-funding, or at least funding from the
people. Well, I mean, here's the thing. He obviously did self-fund in the first phase, but he needs the funding to get there. I understand it's a problem, but I mean, the bottom line is I've been told that Trump says, I'm taking your money, but I'm going to do what I want. You understand that. This money is not buying your support. And the problem is, though, they're then saying, fine, we're not giving you the money, and he's not getting money. So far, he's not getting money because he won't play ball.
Well, that's what has to happen. And then the people have to give him the money through our own donations that are going to be whatever they're going to be. But once you hire on board the Manaforts of this country and the others who demand $20 million for being lobbyists and claim that they put in Bush Sr. when, in fact, he had nothing to do with that, it was Roger Ailes, Baker, and myself. And he had no idea of what he was talking about. It's the same issue, again, of these Republicans who are retread. They're retread one way or the other. The other, Calistino or whatever his name, the slimy guy who goes on Castellano, who goes on television and reprimands Trump. All of these guys are being brought in. Now, either Trump makes a statement and discards all of them and remains in Corey Lane.
Well, hold on. We got Joe Biggs with breaking news, but we'll get back to you, Dr. Pachinik, as well. Stay with us. From Orlando, straight ahead, Joe Biggs. Dr. Steve Pachinik's our guest, stevepachinik.com. He's coming back with us at the start of the next hour. They can pop in any time right now, but Joe Biggs reporting from the ground in Orlando, Florida, where I know we have sources inside the National Level Terrorism Investigation. I'll just leave it at that. And there are reports that they want to target the press. But we've got more information now on the investigation into accomplices of the shooter in Orlando that killed at least 49 people. Joe Biggs, what do you have?
Roger that. Joe Biggs with Infowars.com. Now, we are in Orlando, where we've been investigating this terror attack that took place at the Pulse nightclub. And the FBI has just come out and said that Omar Mateen's wife had knowledge of the attack before. Now, days ago, when she was asked by the FBI if she had any knowledge, she lied and said no. She also admitted to going to the stores with him to buy ammunition. Her and Omar also cased out Disney numerous times, and many other times she drove him to the Pulse nightclub to scope out the place. This could be the actual accomplice, or there could be another person as well. But we've had these reports of multiple shooters inside. I talked to a survivor of the shooting who was actually inside the club. I talked to a guy whose friend was the bartender that night. And each person said they heard multiple guns going off, and it was impossible for one person to do this. So was she part of this? Wonder if they were inspired by the couple in San Bernardino that both went and carried that attack out. So this leaves a lot. You know, we know the father was a Taliban sympathizer. So this is really interesting. I mean, we have someone like Huma Aberdeen right beside Hillary Clinton that has connections to the Muslim Brotherhood, and we have all these attacks starting to happen. There's something fishy going on.
Absolutely. I know this. Obama acts like either the Muslim Brotherhood's blackmailing him or something's going on. This Huma Aberdeen, Dr. Pachinik, What's your information on her? A lot of folks are saying she's a Saudi operative.
Well, she could be. Well, here's where we get into the intelligence community and what I said a long time ago. When the CIA recruits an individual, particularly a president of the United States, there has to be a psychological deficit and lacuna in their personality. In the case of Bill Clinton, it was the fact his mother was a prostitute. She ran a whorehouse in the Hope, Arkansas, and he was nothing but the bastard child of the Johns. In the case of Obama, he was known to be a homosexual in Chicago with Rahm Emanuel, who was trained in ballet dancer, and he was recruited by the CIA repeatedly and basically threatened by them and the Muslim Brotherhood and everything else. That's why the political correctness comes in. Now, in the case of Hillary Clinton, I've known her for years, and I've known her, other family members. She is a well-known lesbian. The reason why she's been recruited and can be threatened is she's had a history of lesbian affairs, which is relevant only to the fact that it's a national security problem. Aberdeen may be her lover. Aberdeen may be her lesbian lover. I could care less. But the point of fact is that not one of our presidents, presently or in the future, other than Trump, is a highly compromised candidate. Who would
and that's why they hate Trump. He's not compromised. He's
no,
open about women.
Let me go into the other element. I have always implicated the Secret Service. They have never served our country. They have always served the person that they were supposed to protect.
Hold on. 70 seconds. We're back with you and Biggs. Stay with us. Third hour, straight ahead. Tell your friends and family. Tune in now, folks. Sign up for the free newsletter. By the way, I'm going
to
be on 6 to 7 tonight, 6 to 8. Ask me anything at InfoWars.com video feed. I forgot to talk about that. The empire we face is systems of corruption and crony centralization. We're the Renaissance. We're not perfect, but that's what I promote. It's what I push. It's what's given us everything good we've got today, in my view. Dr. Steve Pachinik's our guest. Joe Biggs is calling in with a breaking report. He's been filing amazing reports, newsmaking reports from Orlando at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. So finishing it with both men, then I'm coming back and covering all the news, video clips, you name it, audio clips. Dr. Pachinik, you were finishing a point about the Secret Service being sycophantic.
They're totally sycophants. They have been. Their only duty is to protect the person in charge. They knew very well what happened in 9/11. They knew very well that the Clintons were compromised, even though there was one book that came out and that was it. They knew very well Obama's history of homosexuality before and after and in the future. They know very well what the issues are with the Clintons. And in fact, we're funding nothing more than the Royal Guard, who has no loyalty to America. This whole issue of the Treasury bills and the fake dollars, that's nonsense. The point of fact is the Secret Service has to be cleaned out, has to be reorganized, and it's only a man like Trump or others like myself who could come in and fire them summarily. They're basically drunks, they're whoremongers, and they really waste our money.
Dr. Pachinik, I want to briefly come back. This is a short segment. I want to finish it with Biggs and just ask you, with your sources, but also your trained eye, where the country is now, where the world is briefly, and what you would do if you were Donald Trump. Because I know for a fact a lot of the info from the show gets directly to his desk. So I'm going to put you on hold, come back to you after the break.
No problem.
T-minus 4.5 minutes. Biggs, I know you've got a lot of intel. Follow those video reports. We'll get some of those there in the fourth hour and up on InfoWars.com. What else can you report on the ground from Orlando?
All right, so what we have so far is actually before, I was actually hanging out last night and Billy Corgan ran into me and we were hanging out, but before that happened, something really interesting happened. This man walked up to me and he goes, "Joe Biggs?" And I go, "Yeah." He goes, "I have some information for you." He says, "One of my really good friends is Louis Bourbano, the guy that was holding the door shut at the nightclub. And he said he wanted me to tell you what happened." So the guy came up to me and they just called me like an hour ago and told me I could go public and tell this whole story. But the kid's nervous. He's been getting death threats. But he said what happened was that they were running outside of the nightclub. He opened the door and saw that it was a gated, a fenced-in area, and there was a few people out there, and he decided to shut the door so the shooter could not come outside and start killing those people. So he held the door shut, from what the story is, he held the door shut until people were able to pry that fence open and get a hole big enough for people to go through, and then that's when he removed himself from that area and let people come out. But he was scared that if everyone ran out there and they were caged in like a whole bunch of chickens, that they would just get mowed down and killed. So that's why he held the door shut. And they showed me a video of him soaked in blood, covered in blood from head to toe, in a video, that they don't want to use it.
Well, again, I should have thought Megyn Kelly's such a snake. She spends everything. So if we were wrong, we apologize for going with her report. That makes a lot more sense. Tell them, don't be scared. Get all this out right now, Joe, and just really pressure these folks.
He's going through depression right now. His buddy's worried that he might, do something bad. He's been getting death threats. People are coming up to him, and he's scared. I mean, he's a younger guy. He is a homosexual. He had no ill intention of anything. He was just doing what he thought was best.
I understand. And in the time and all that, and then Megyn Kelly misrepresented it, perhaps, and then we took it wrong. Now that more of the story's out, part of the problem was he was looking at his phone. He seemed confused, so it made him look guilty. He needs to come on air and clarify it, and then that's what will reverse all this. So if you can get him to come on via video Skype or tape it, tell him, get it out, explain what happened, don't stumble through it, and then he'll be left alone. He needs to respond to that, don't you think, Joe?
Yeah, I agree with you completely. I was telling his friend that he needs to come forward at some time, maybe once he calms down.
Absolutely. It'll all blow over. He's going to be fine. But we'll try to clarify that as we get more info. It looked really bad, but perhaps he wasn't getting good audio. Thank you, Joe. Get on that and then pop it anytime you need to. We're coming back. Ragtag as it is, this is a real threat fusion center where we look at the globalist, we look at government, we look at private individuals. I'm trying to get more analysts, more people in here because it's just overwhelming. It's like we're drinking through straws and they're hitting us with Niagara Falls. You know, about a week ago, this ISIS, or a week and a half ago, this ISIS hit list went out. And it was encrypted. We have a lot of high-level hackers that are friends of the show. We've had a copy of it. Really, no one else has it. It's been expunged. And we have all this national media emailing us. And I think we're going to do a story on this. Asking us for the list. And we're not going to put the list out for an obvious reason. Yes, we could publish the list and get millions of viewers to InfoWars.com. We're not going to do that. And we're talking, Merkel Phelan, that has the list in there, that got it from one of these white hat hackers, he has to explain to the media in emails, stop emailing. Don't publish the list if you find it, because the jihadis aren't being directed by a central group. They're like fire ants that go off pheromones. They just go off the movement and copycat events. And so if they get the list, that gives them the imperative to go follow their orders. These are like Fantasyland loons that imagine that they're in Mission Impossible and they get their message that destroys in, 60 seconds. So we have the list. Obviously, law enforcement has it. We've done articles like, hey, there's 8 people on the hit list in Orlando. And then we've tried to point out to law enforcement, hey, have you contacted these folks? And some of the people have not been contacted. So I would think that, and there's about 3,000 people on the list. Some of it's duplicated. So we think about 2,000 names. So that's going on. But it really blows me away. The mainstream media is so stupid that they want to have the list and are saying they want to publish the list. I mean, I'm no rocket scientist when it comes to this stuff, Dr. Steve Pachinik, but isn't it smart not to release the list?
I think it's very smart. That's one of the reasons why you should remain on the air and not exhaust yourself. One of the reasons why you have become very important, it's not just you, it's the entire Alex Jones group and phenomenon. We shifted the entire narrative, starting with 9/11, to the point where we now can have a real voice, where we can speak with credibility, and the mainstream media has no more credibility. So what you did was to flip the entire system 180 degrees. That's why I keep on coming on to your show, but also I'm concerned about you as a friend, that you not get so excited, because there's so many wars coming in that the American public, whom we deal with, the true Americans, need to know. They have to be armed, they have to be educated, they have to react and be proactive, and they have. the phenomenon of Trump did not come from mainstream media. It came from you and the millions of others who were disgusted with what happened, including the Democrats, the independents, and many of us who kept fighting for 14 years. You've been fighting for 14 years, day and night. And so you become an asset that's so important. That's why I could call up and talk to your assistants and say, look, this is great what you're doing, but on the other hand, we have to persevere. I agree,
and I wasn't selfish earlier bringing that up, but you are, you know, a smart guy. I've never been more upset at the system, and I try to not get upset. I'm not, like, you know, enjoying getting upset. I just physically get upset by all this sometimes.
No, I understand that, Alex, and I understand you're an emotional, exceedingly bright guy. But in reality, we need your energy to continue in a way that's systematic, the way you have your reporters on the ground.
No, I agree. We're trying to do it. I know, of course,
Boggs was correct. And any one of us who's been in combat, which we have, we knew very well that one person could not have taken out 50 people plus 49 others, 103 people. So there had to be other people involved. Once again, it goes back to home base. We always have to look at home base, at the CIA for recruiting the father, the FBI involved in this absurd investigation, which is a disaster. That means he has to resign. Loretta Lynch has to resign. The people who were hit or hurt have to file suit against G4S because they were responsible for this security guard who had two licenses for acquiring armament. So the president was wrong. As usual, he lies. He's a sociopath, and he lied. The Orlando shooter had the right with two licenses to acquire.
That's right. Hillary's saying we got to pass more laws, make sure they have licenses.
No, this guy
jumped through all the hoops.
No, that's absurd. He had the right and legitimacy. Where the problem lies is that the people who were involved and their families should now sue G4S, which is a CIA assistant, MI6. It's a disastrous corporation that has over 600,000 mercenaries of the lowest quality. They claim they had evaluated Mateen and they did a psychological operation. Nonsense. That's a lie. They work at the lowest level, at the cheapest level, and if you look at their history, they're continuously merging with other companies because they have a very liquid system in the FTSE or the London Exchange where they just pick up all kinds of junk companies and put them on security. It's an absurd company which has been nothing more than the British, entity that has really failed all over the world and claims that they're premier. They're not premier. And the second part of this is very clear. When the FBI investigates a family, there's no question the father, the wife, and everyone else around them is in collusive element. For them to deny that or not to know that, the FBI has to be reorganized.
Shows they're trying to cover up the fact that they knew this was coming and basically stood down.
They're incompetent. Forget anything else. They were collusive in 9/11, and they're incompetent now. Either way, they should not exist. Either way, the secret.
All right. Well, Dr. Pechenik, we're out of time. I want to get you back up in the near future to talk about your book. I've read it.
I want to talk about what's happening because Trump has to understand he has to come in, clean out the government, and put in people who have a history of being effective, not a history of lobbying and working with Republicans. He has to understand his instincts are correct, but he needs to go more effectively against the
Democrats. All right, well, let's do this. Let's get you up. Let's get you up for 30 minutes, an hour sometime next week to talk about your advice to Trump. We'll do it then. Thank you, Doctor.
Your audience. Bye.
Thank you, Dr. Pechenik. I would have aired this video days ago, but we have a schedule when we're going to release these Tim Kennedy vignettes, and so we were going to do it tomorrow, but because of obviously what happened Saturday night, Sunday morning, we're going to move this up a day and air it now. We're going to post this video to Infowars.com after we premiere it here right now. This is Tim Kennedy, a Special Forces soldier, Delta Force, you name it, warning people that political correctness will kill you and that ISIS attacks are coming. And this was shot back on June 1st. And he's saying, get ready. And telling people, you have to not follow political correctness. People at his work wouldn't call the police on him because of political correctness. It went on and on and on. So let's go ahead and premiere this piece.
Political correctness these days are getting people killed. forbid you actually say something that's not politically correct, then you're a bigot. Then you're a racist. Then you're a misogynist sexist. Talk about tolerance. Paris, France, one of the most beautiful places on the planet. I think it's like, you know, city of romance, music, culture, food, philosophy. They're tolerant. For years now, you know, a decade, they've been welcoming with open arms the refugees from the Middle East. And while their arms have been opened and letting these people in, they've been taken advantage of. Now here we are, 10 years later, the tolerance that they've demonstrated, you'd think that maybe they would get some form of grace from the extremists. No, they see weakness. They're maybe misunderstanding that this kindness is weakness. And in the instance of France, it was weakness.
All right, we are just getting word now. What appears to be a shooting, maybe multiple shootings in the city of Paris. Police officials there say at least two are dead from an explosion in a bar near Paris Stadium, and separately a shootout in a Paris restaurant.
The Islamic State has claimed responsibility for the attacks. French President Francois Hollande vowed to use all means necessary inside or outside of the country to defeat the terrorist army.
The scene on the ground across Paris appears to be chaotic, but what we are hearing from a French television network, that network, and this is unconfirmed, are reporting that 18 people are dead.
Europe might be lost because of their tolerance. Tolerance and political correctness, they go hand in hand. You know, they're two diseases. They're like a virus that is, like, once it's caught, you just want to stay with it, but slowly it's eroding and killing you. You're going to die. Political correctness and tolerance is doing to our society. You know, we're trying to be nice. We don't want to offend anybody. And by doing that, we're getting weaker. Stop being and call things how you see them. You know, we have politicians right now that will say anything to get elected. They'll lie at every opportunity.
Well, have you always told the truth?
I've always tried to. Always. Always.
The Supreme Court is wrong on the Second Amendment, and I am going to make that case every chance I get.
That's the thing about the truth and political correctness. They can't coexist. You either have what's true and what's right, or then you have what's socially acceptable. Those two things are exclusive. They can't live together. Believe in the truth, live in the truth, speak the truth, and for sake, just get rid of the political correctness.
Now, we just premiered that video here for the first time. They're about to upload it to YouTube. They're about to put it on our Facebook page. It needs to go viral. But I want to just take this short clip of what I'm about to say right now, live on radio and TV, and put it on the front of the video we're about to upload so you can get it out to your friends, your family, your neighbors, everybody you know. You ready? Here it is. It was June 1st. I'm going from memory here. Teleprompter free, folks. I'm trying to remember. Yeah, it was June 1st he shot that. It was June 1st, right? Yeah. Okay, here we go. It's Tuesday, June 14th, 2016. 14 days ago, Tim Kennedy, Special Forces soldier, patriot, was here warning us of imminent jihad attacks inside of the United States. And just 12 days later, his warning came true. Here's a video that we weren't going to air until the future in a film that we're producing that you're now going to get a chance to see today when Ted Kennedy issued his warning. Now, some people can say, hey, you know, tell us something we don't know. I understand that. I know you're informed. I know you understand. We have to get this out to our friends and neighbors and community that are in the dark, that are blaming the Second Amendment for the tragic mass murder in Orlando. And Tim Kennedy's warning you to get prepared, get ready, get a firearm, learn to defend yourself, because the government isn't going to do it. The SWAT team stood down in Orlando for 3 hours. This is outrageous. Our borders are wide open. They're not even vetting the refugees. This guy's father was a jihadi calling for the death of gays. His imam was. The FBI's hands were tied, and they weren't even allowed to go after these people. That's because of the political control that Islam has directly out of Saudi Arabia, and that Wahhabists have bought off our government from Hillary Clinton to Barack Obama to General Petraeus. All right, that's the clip right there. I'm so busy, folks. I just do stuff live on air. Take that clip, kind of edit it down, and I want to throw it right on the front of that video. I want it on Facebook. I want it on Twitter. I want to, because they've got a video feed as well. I want to pump it on every video feed out there. I want it on Paul Watson's Facebook video feed. I mean, we've got all these video feeds that reach millions of people apiece, and we'll only put a video on one video feed here, one video feed there. And quite frankly, it's because I got three people to upload videos. But by the time we shoot them and edit them and all this and pay for everything and fly people around the world and do this, we don't have the crew for two more camera people and a couple more uploaders and editors. We need it. So we've got the very best water filtration systems, a huge selection, 20% off today, running a huge special at InfoWarsStore.com. We have the best, widest selection of non-GMO heirloom open pollinated seeds. Dozens of top companies discounted InfoWarsStore.com. We have the best indoor air purification systems. We have the best G-Shock watches and the best optics. What we sell has been approved and signed on to by Navy SEALs, Delta operators, you name it. We sell the highest quality products discounted with the widest selection at InfoWarsStore.com. And when you go there and you buy your non-GMO, high-quality storable foods the last 25 years, or you get a book or a film or Hillary for Prison shirt, or you get Supermel Vitality or Anthroplex or Lung Cleanse or X2 Survival Shield Nascent Iodine or Colloidal Silver Silver Bullet or Living Defense Parasite Cleanse, your purchase makes everything possible that we do here on the air Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Back weeknights, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWars Nightly News, and then the Sunday show, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. And then on top of it, I'm doing a two-hour Reddit, Ask Me Anything, for the first time ever, tonight, 6 to 8 p.m. Central Time. You can ask me anything. Then we're going to be airing excerpts of this next week on the main broadcast. You go to InfoWars.com/AMA or Ask Me Anything. InfoWars.com/AMA or sign up for our free newsletter. InfoWars.com/newsletters. Put in your email and we will send you not just the latest articles and videos a couple times a day. And we send out usually two emails a day. We don't harass you too bad. Promo codes, things like that. But we also send you the links to special events so you don't miss them. InfoWars.com/newsletter. Ask Me Anything tonight, commercial free, 2 hours, 6 to 8 p.m. And some people will say, I just addressed this here. Well, what do you mean? That's when the nightly news is on. That isn't how it works. We're not in competition with ourselves here at InfoWars. I don't care if somebody's doing a Facebook mentions while I'm on air. I don't care if when I'm on air, somebody else is doing a live feed somewhere. That's what it's all about. That's why I have other talk show hosts on, other radio networks, other TV people on who are fighting for freedom. This is a war. This isn't about being the biggest fish in the pond. It's not about, you know, making the most money. It is about survival of Western civilization and Christianity and basic Renaissance ideas of the Enlightenment. The Christianity allowed to come forth. That's under attack by totalitarians on the left, radical Islam, which is Orthodox Islam, and other criminal movements. They are allied together in their predatory hatred of free will, of open free societies. They are what we call evil. And it does exist, and it's moving against the world right now. So I want to thank you all for your support. You go to InfoWars.com. You'll see lots of links and feeds. InfoWars.com/show. I'll have an event area, not just the nightly news, obviously links to that, and the rebroadcast of the daytime show, what we call InfoWars Live, that you're watching or listening to right now, but also the special events. But the easiest is InfoWars.com/AMA. Ask Me Anything. First time I'm doing this on Reddit, reaching out to other big communities on the internet to not just preach to the choir. Now, joining us is Dr. Bill Warner till the end of this hour. Then David Knight comes in to host the fourth hour, a fresh horse in the fight. will be honchoing and anchoring the broadcast. We're going to break here in about 3 minutes. We're going to come back in the next segment that's 18 minutes long. We'll have plenty of time to talk and go over this. He was just on for his first visit with us last week from politicalislam.com. I'm not going to go over his whole bio again, but he's well-researched and been around the world. And he has been basically warning of the truth that Islam itself in the first phase acts nice. But once they hit 5-10%, they start attacking. And we're now seeing that with Orlando. He predicted attacks just last week. And a few days later, it happened. So sorry to say you've been proven right yet again, sir. Thank you for joining us.
Glad to be here, Alex. I love what you did.
Well, thank you, sir. We're just raising the alarm together here as sentinels. We got 2 minutes till break. Your first thoughts on what's happened?
Well, it's the jihad, stupid. I mean, we're doing it once again. If you sit in my seat, one of the things you realize is it's like an endless loop film clip. And there will be a time 6 weeks from now when we won't remember this, and then wham, we'll get hit again. And then we'll go, oh. So it's my job to connect all the dots. And the reason it's easy for me to do my job is Islam has been doing the same thing for 1,400 years. What's happened in Orlando is shocking to some, but I'm afraid to say that for someone as much as myself, it's business as usual.
Let's cover a tidbit here first before we come back and get into the whole waterfront. What about this constant connection of homosexuality in Islam, but then it's closeted, but if you get caught doing it, you're executed, and pedophilia is pretty much legal, isn't it?
Well, pedophilia comes from the Sunnah of Muhammad, in which he married Aisha when she was 6 and consummated the marriage when she was 9. But homosexuality, one of the things when you're dealing with Islam is you have to precisely define your words. And when Islam speaks of homosexuality, they're talking about love. So if a man loves another man, that's wrong. But if an older man is having sex with a younger boy, this is domination or power. So it may look like homosexuality to you, but since he doesn't necessarily love the boy, it's not actually homosexuality. It's just an exercise in power.
So it's rape. It's okay.
Kind of like that.
Just God. What a freak show.
Well, I mean, like I say, we just have to, every time we deal with Islam, we need to define our words carefully because Islam always has its own private hidden meanings.
Well, let's decode that and what you expect to come next. With our guest straight ahead, I'm Alex Jones. My website's Infowars.com. We just had Dr. Steve Pachinik on. Now we have Dr. Bill Warner on. His website's PoliticalIslam.com. Stay with us. David Knight is coming up in the fourth hour. We're going back to our guests in a moment. I'm going to be doing a two-hour Ask Me Anything first time on Reddit this evening, 6 to 8 p.m. Central. And there'll be some surprises, and we'll have a free video feed. It's not just going to be me sitting there online typing. We're going to have a free video feed, obviously, at Infowars.com/AMA. And you can also find it's going to be on one of the most popular areas of Reddit, the_Donald. So Reddit.com/r/the_Donald. We're going to tweet that out. We're going to Facebook that out. And this is just more and more special events that I'm going to be doing. Obviously, and a lot of these are going to be on PrisonPlanet.tv for InfoWars Nightly News viewers as well. I'll be doing some special reports coming up when the Nightly News ends. I'll do like an hour live sometime just for folks that are subscribers to the Nightly News. Because I'm just intensifying everything I'm doing because so much is unfolding, so much is happening right now. The best way for you to be able to find the feed is just subscribe to the free newsletter, InfoWars.com/ newsletter, and you just put in your email there. We're going back to our guest here in about 60 seconds, Dr. Bill Warner. Before I go any further, look at this story. Russian government hackers penetrate DNC, stole opposition research to Donald Trump. And, of course, this is out of the Washington Post. We have no idea if any of this is true. It's one of the most disreputable, deceiving publications out there. But it is the Russian government that broke in and proved the carbon tax was a fraud and had the UN saying we got to hide the decline and, you know, carry out the big scam. So I guess I got to say thank you, Russians, for that. Report, wife knew he would attack. I'm reading from Drudge. Claims tried to stop. I said on Sunday his family probably radicalized him. Ties to suicide bomber in Syria deeper than thought. Drag queen bartender recounts horror like a fish in a barrel. Playing dead to stay alive. Police account of decisions contains crucial gaps. Yeah, the cops stood down for 3 hours. Killer visited club dozens of times. Male classmate says Omar asked him out. Use gay dating app. Ex-wife, he was gay. But this is the schizophrenia of these Islamic crazies. They will sit there, go out and date guys, but then go kill them because they're gay. But it's not gay when he does it. It's just, it's so weird. It's so freakazoid. And I don't get why the left is so allied with it. It's crazy. There's so much more I want to get to. A lot of stuff up on Infowars.com as well. So much unfolding right now. David Icke's been covering a lot of the news we haven't gotten to that's on Infowars.com coming up in the next hour. But there's a very hardcore John Bowne report, too, that everybody needs to see that I hope he'll air during the fourth hour because I don't have time now. But it's really powerful. Headline is Orlando, America under attack by its own government. We are producing hardcore videos and articles. We broke with WorldNet Daily and then Drudge magnified it. But the point is that Hillary blocked, before she left the State Department, investigation of this mosque. I mean, it's crazy that his father is a jihadist calling for killing homosexuals. And then you turn around and the left is blaming gun owners and veterans and patriots for this. It is just a mass Stockholm syndrome. Let me ask one of the top Islam experts out there. I'm not going to go over his bio. You can go to his site and see it for yourself. It's amazing. Best-selling author as well, Dr. Bill Warner. He's got a lot of points he wants to go over. Just run through it fast because, you know, we got you on short notice here today, and there's a lot of news obviously breaking. But politicalislam.com is the site. Why is our government guarding him? Why are they protecting him? Why aren't they going after the father? Why aren't they going after the imam? I don't know if you've seen the video of him like a snake going, we kill them, the gays, to be compassionate. We will kill them. I mean, and then the left is busy blaming conservatives. This is just insane. Is it Stockholm Syndrome? Or why is the left so allied with these people, sir?
Well, you know, it's not just the left. I find that there are people here in Nashville, Tennessee, who would normally consider themselves conservatives in many matters, but they don't want to engage Islam. And the reason is, if you do engage Islam and say anything about it, you're called a racist, hater, bigot, Islamophobe.
So it's cowardice. It's cowardice.
Yes, that's it. You know, we've gotten as a nation a little too rich. Now, when I tell people that, they're horrified that you could ever be too rich. And in a strange way, we've become to where we don't want to tend to anything except ourselves. And now that we're under a civilizational attack, and as a result, we've gone complacent. We want to hire professionals to do our work for us. If the military can do it, fine. The law enforcement can do it, fine. But if there's work here, we've got to do ourselves. As a civilization, we have to acquaint ourselves with what's attacking us. And this is an information war. It's the reason I love the title of your show. This is not a war we're going to win with bullets and bombs, but it's a war of ideas. We have to understand that this is a very serious piece of business. We have an enemy. The enemy is political Islam, and it's here to take over our civilization.
Breaking down the latest attack, what jumps out for you?
Well, the thing that doesn't jump out with me, as I say, is this just one more attack. Right now, we're excited about this, but there will come a time in which we won't be excited about this, and we'll go back to sleep. It's like every time an event like this happens, we come up to here, and then the awareness starts going down, then it'll come back up. So to me, this is all a matter of business as usual. I guess I've become inured to it. I'm like a triage surgeon. It's just another event.
And when do we get cultural exhaustion and maybe make it a holiday, like one day a week Muslims are allowed to kill us, and maybe it becomes a cultural right and you're racist or homophobic if you don't support suicide bombing? Maybe it'll become a national pastime.
Well, I must admit, Alex, you've now posed a new idea, which I've not heard before.
Well, I was being sarcastic, but imagine if they actually completely took over, that would be the case. It would be normal.
Well, what happens is that there's a degradation of civilization. There's a wonderful word called dhimmi, D-H-I-M-M-I, and it's the dhimmi status, which is the dhimmi lives within the Sharia law context, but continues to have their own private life. And so that's what we have here, is a form of dhimmitude in which the Sharia is being pressed on us more and more. We're not supposed to criticize Muhammad. We're not supposed to tell a Muhammad joke. And yet what we find is the dhimmi has something that is, he is degraded. And how is he degraded? Well, he's no longer in charge of the society he lives in. And that's sort of what's happening here, is more and more we feel less and less in control of what's going on. Alex, there are things that are happening now that you would never have believed that would happen. I mean, whether it's putting urinals in the girls' bathroom, I mean, you can't predict all these things.
But I find it fascinating, the point that once they get to be a certain percentage of population, they almost make us pay a tax and submit then, even though we're not Muslims, is what you're saying?
What the problem with Islam is it's not just a religion. If Islam were just a religion, I wouldn't be here talking to you. I would be in my wood shop making another piece of furniture, which is where I was on 9/11. So the problem is it's a political system, and that's what I concern ourselves with. But by the way, understanding that Islam is a political system is the key to defeating Islam. You know, as a religion, you get protection in our society. And I coined the term political Islam the day after the 9/11 attacks because I realized that we would never defeat a religion because there's too much religious protection in this country. But we can defeat a political system. So I coined the term political Islam because that's the part that confirms you and me. I'm not involved in the religion of Islam, and I don't care about the religion of Islam one way or the other. They pray five times a day. I don't care. It doesn't have any impact on me. But, oh, by the way, let me use prayer here as an illustration of the difference between political Islam and religious Islam. More in Europe, it happens a lot, but now it's beginning to happen in the United States, where on a Friday, Muslims will commandeer the streets in order to pray. You may have seen pictures of this in New York. Now then, you say, well, that's your religious right. Stop and look at what's happening here. The religious part is the prayer. But when you commandeer the street, that is a political action. Alex, if I go out here in my neighborhood and commandeer the street, I'm going to meet some people who with blue lights on their car, and they're not going to have a very good attitude about me. It is illegal to block traffic unless you're a Muslim. And then all of a sudden, that political action gets the guise of a religious covering. So it's politics that we care about. And it's what we need to do to defeat Islam is we have to accept it.
So it's all definitions. And you talk about how they have like gang language. They have code words that we don't understand. Break some examples of that down, Doctor.
Oh, let's see. How about innocent? It frequently happens that after a killing, they will say, oh, well, Islam forbids the killing of innocents. Well, it does. But you see, I am guilty. I am not innocent. And I bet you're guilty, too. What are you guilty of, Alex? You're guilty of denying the prophethood of Muhammad and the perfection of the Quran. So that's the problem, is that we have special words that have special meaning. And that, like I say, innocent is just the same one that comes up all the time.
But it's okay if you're not an innocent. So they're saying, oh, we're against killing innocent, knowing that that's basically a code word, but they're saying, but you're not innocent.
That's exactly correct. As a matter of fact, it goes further than this. It's they haven't drugged this out on this event. By the way, have you noticed that there's always the same denials after a jihad event? It's like, well, now we don't want to be blaming Muslims. You know, Islam is a religion of peace. And I know this Muslim, he's a wonderful person. And if we criticize Muslims, that's Muslim bashing. So have you noticed this again and again quality of what everyone drags out?
Well, the quote top imam there in Florida came out and said, do not make this political and turn it into an event to lecture everyone.
Well, you know, I preach just the opposite doctrine. I'm not interested in the lecturing, but I'm interested in people learning. That's the reason I'm interested in being on your show. This is an information war. If we would ever accept that, then we could win this war. And if it's an information war, this means that everybody has to partake in it. For instance, the religious leaders need to start partaking in this war and stand up for what is a political action is that Christians are being killed in Africa and the Middle East on a daily basis. Those are political actions. And we need to get people who first understand the fact that it's going on. And the other thing is we need to get religious leaders involved in opposing this. So it's a civilizational war and we need to bring everybody in on the act.
What about Islamic espionage? They're buying the politicians off. Saudi Arabia alone funds 20% of Hillary's campaign.
You know, Islam is very big on, there are four kinds of jihad. There's jihad of the sword, which is what we all heard here. Then there's jihad of speech, jihad of writing, and there's jihad of money. As a matter of fact, the Quran goes on again and again and says that every Muslim must contribute money towards jihad. And by the way, contributing money towards jihad gives you the same blessing as if you had committed the act of jihad itself. So Saudi Arabia spends more money on implementing Wahhabism around the world than communists did at the height of the Cold War. So the fact, and Muhammad, by the way, it's clearly written, would use money in order to influence both politics and religion. So the fact that Islam is using money is also part of the fact that they understand civilizational war. I am a strange admirer of the Islamic concepts of war because they're so total. I argue that Muhammad was the greatest warrior who ever lived. Alex, nobody dies today for Alexander the Great, Caesar, or Napoleon, but someone died today because of Muhammad's military leadership. So money is simply part of a civilizational jihad, just like immigration is part of a civilizational jihad. Islam has the most brilliant concepts of war that I've ever read. It uses everything. I just told you earlier how praying in the street becomes a political action and part of a political war. By the way, this goes on long enough until finally it just becomes the way that people do business. And they just say, well, it's Muslims, they can do what they want to do. So Islam understands war and understands it involves money. You look like you're old enough to understand that some people you can't buy, but you can definitely rent. It's hard to find someone that money doesn't influence. But I'm shocked that you think that money would influence Hillary's political position, really.
It is amazing. Do you think every time there's an attack, people are getting more concerned about Islam, or do you think they're starting to go to sleep and get that fatigue from it?
I think that we're winning on the basis of, Alex, if there were only jihad of speech, writing, and money, we would lose this. We wouldn't stand a chance. The only thing that happens is after every jihad event that hits the news, let's be clear here. It is a rare jihad event that comes into the news. It has to be big. But when it does, all of a sudden people are learning because they have their face shoved into it. Alex, we're beginning to win at one, this is going to sound strange, but we're beginning to win at one level of the information war, which is we now dominate the comment section. No matter how liberal the newspaper may be, if they offer comments, we find that our word is getting in and being heard. So it's sort of shock learning. And
the public's learning the nomenclature. They're learning the Islamic terms. They're learning that this has all been hidden from us.
Well, people are learning in general. For instance, people now understand that there is such a thing as political Islam, that it's not just religion. So I'm optimistic on this point. Our problem is not at the grassroots level. Alex, our problem is at the top. We're betrayed at the top. The elites are selling us down the road. And it's not just on Islam, by the way. I go to Europe twice a year, and the EU has become an organization of elites that's slowly destroying
nations. Oh, absolutely. No, I mean, they're globalists, and that's why they've opened the door up for the Islamists to come in. Why is the EU allied with the Islamists?
This is very strange to me. However, its roots are in oil. I was reading a book on one of the master spies of before the First World War, and something very interesting happened. And that was that the British, who had dominated the world by the use of ships, had fueled their ships with coal. Then it became very clear that the future of naval warfare lay in oil. It was at this point that scholarship at Oxford and Cambridge and other university sites, began to view Islam in a more and more favorable light. Before 1920, there were some great books written by university scholars about Islam. But after the need for oil came about, all of a sudden Britain became more and more compliant and more
That's right. And the British Empire basically set up these current states, so thought it controlled it, made a deal with it, and now it's infiltrated the global imperial model. We're not under a British Empire, but the British model is still kind of the Anglo-American global government system. That's now caught the Islamic virus, and that's how it's replicating and taking over.
It is. And, you know, what's really terrible about all this is everybody who's involved in accommodating ourselves to Islam view themselves as nice people. I've met people who oppose me and my politics, and their motivation is good. That is, from their limited point
of
view.
They think being nice and be friendly and don't be hateful. Well, they want to put my wife in a cage. Doesn't matter. You be nice and you sit there and you take it. And you now, don't you say Islam blew that building up. Don't you say they want to. Now, they don't have any slavery. They're good people. You're bad. The West is bad. You're bad. By the way, this radio show that started 21 years ago but syndicated for 20, 19 and a half, funds the entire news operation, the films, the books, the news videos, the newscasts, the audio vignettes that are reaching 26 to 28 million people a week conservatively. Those are very, very conservative numbers. And we're growing exponentially. So we don't just bring you the best products and things that we personally have vetted and used. It's also supporting the InfoWar and a platform to reach so many people. I'm going to go 5 minutes the next hour with our guests, and then David Knight is going to take over. And I'll be back this evening, 6 to 8 p.m. with an Ask Me Anything, the first time I've done it, with Reddit video links at Infowars.com/AMA. Now, before I go any further, we have 20% off on all Alexa Pure water filtration systems. And it's already the lowest price you're going to find out there anywhere. Everybody should be filtering their water with all the toxic stuff, all the glyphosates, all the chemicals, all the gasoline runoff in the water. It's one of the biggest things you can do is drink purified water. And it's so expensive to get bottled water, even if it's truly clean bottled water. The way to do it, in my view, is gravity-fed filters. We have a wide selection of them. The Alexa Pure is excellent. And the Pro Pure systems are excellent as well. You can check all those out, but 20% off on Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. And then finally, SolutionsFromScience.com are wonderful folks, longtime sponsors, and they only come around with sponsorship every once in a while when they end up getting a surplus of whatever the latest high-quality solar panel systems are, and they've got a great unit and control system that's incredibly well-priced right now at SolutionsFromScience.com. They have solar power generators and are offering a discount to listeners who visit their website. That's solutionsfromscience.com, or give them a call, 877-327-0365, 877-327-0365. But it's our sponsorship, and it is the products we sell as well that make all this possible. Going back to Dr. Bill Werner of politicalislam.com, getting back to the subject we were covering before the break. I mean, there's so many angles of this. What should we hit now?
You know what I would like to talk about next? Is I heard part, I didn't hear it, I read it. Trump's calling out, I think he calls it radical or extreme Islam. This is the wrong term to use. It's very common, it's used by a lot of people. And a friend said to me in a conversation that Obama was rattling Trump's cage because of calling it extreme Islam or radical Islam. Now, I disagree with Trump and I disagree with Obama. What we have here, there are two forms of Islam. One of the key things about learning about Islam is to understand it's dualistic. It always has two manifestations. A 20-second summary. Muhammad preached the religion of Islam for 13 years in Mecca and persuaded 150 Arabs to become Muslims. He moved to Medina. He migrated. That began the process of jihad in politics. He had 100 events of jihad in the last 9 years of his life. And when he died, every Arab in Central Arabia was a Muslim. Here's what the lesson to take home from this is. There are two forms of Islam, a religious Islam and then a political Islam, which includes jihad. So what we should say is that it's not extreme Islam, because if you're doing what Muhammad did, how can you be extreme? No, it is Medinan Islam or jihad form of Islam, so that we need to start using the precise words. We need to make our own words and use them, because if what you may view as 9/11 as something extreme, that's on the basis of your ethical system and your system of life. If you're doing what Muhammad did, it cannot be extreme. It cannot be radical. It is normative and normal. So we need to learn to start using the right word.
Sure, and understand why that 99% of terrorism worldwide is from Islamicists, and then why is our government defending it? It's just crazy. It's absolutely over the top. Saudi Arabia won't take one Syrian refugee when they finance the five-year war to overthrow that country. Saudi Arabia executes gays every week, chops their heads off. Saudi Arabia is financing all sorts of control, mosques being built all over the world, taking Islamic areas that aren't that radical, radicalizing them. Our government's totally in love with it, overthrows governments that are secular like Saddam Hussein, comparatively speaking. And you go back to the untold story behind Saudi Arabia's 41-year U.S. debt secret. I was told this 20 years ago on air by Patriots. It's now all been declassified. Here's another one. Saudi Arabia warns of economic fallout if Congress passes 9/11 bill. 28 pages. Saudi Daily. Satanic bills allows kingdom to be sued. Will open the gates of hell for U.S. U.S. secretly destroyed evidence in trial of accused 9/11 masterminds. And Hillary has gotten 20% of her funding, according to the Associated Press, from Saudi Arabia alone. How could any, quote, feminist out there who claims they care about women be for Hillary when she's in the hip pocket of the Gulf states, Dr. Warner?
Well, you know, you and I would use the term feminist, but I'm not so sure there's any feminist left. How can you call yourself or if there are feminists, they seem to be concerned with the fact that if a woman has an MBA, then she should be the chief executive officer. They love to talk about that glass ceiling.
It's all about power grabs. It's not about actually taking care of anybody.
It really isn't, because there are several classes of people in the United States that I condemn broadside, which means they're not everybody, but I say 90 to 95%. They're feminist and clergy, because the feminist will tolerate somehow or another and make nice with Islam or accept its treatment of women, which is brutal and wrong. And yet, have we ever seen any marches by feminists? I was noted with amusement that liberals are signing a petition to put urinals in the women's bathroom. So they can get caught up in things that have to do with feminism or femininity like that.
Mindless distractions. Or they're mad that they'll henpeck a woman who wants to stay home with her kids so they get brought up better. But then they're fine if Saudi Arabia has women in pens.
You know, Alex, you keep trying to ask me these questions as though I'm going to be able to make sense out of them all. But I cannot explain why women who are otherwise good people will sit there and go to an interfaith gathering and hear women talk about how wonderful that Islam was the first to give women their rights, that Islam protects women. So listen to all these things that Islam is supposed to be good for women and just sit there. And like baby birds, when the mother bird feeds them, they drop the worm down the mouth.
Meanwhile, ISIS is selling six-year-olds into sex slavery and gets Saudi Arabian approval. I'm going to throw up.
You know, you're reaching the point where I'm going to teach you a phrase which the professionals in my business use. You cannot make this crap up. I'm serious. I mean, I deal with professionals around the world, and occasionally we all just shake our heads and go, we can't make this up. How would you do this? Islam is, when you enter the world of Islam, you enter a world in which everything has two meanings and everything is upside down. And everything you think you know, it's the opposite of that. It's like Islam is permanent opposite day.
It's like, I'm going to go kill all these gay people, but they have sex with men. And it's just, but it's okay because we did it this way, but these guys got to die because they did it that way. And we're liberal, by the way, so shut up. The guy's a Democratic Party voter, so he goes and kills a bunch of Democrats.
You know, and by the way, did you ever think about this? My bet is that most of the people who were killed in the Orlando shooting were Obama voters. But you know, we're laughing here. And yet the truth of the matter is Islam is the enemy of the liberal, the conservative, the progressive, the left.
I think it's the enemy of itself. My God, who wants to live under the way those countries are? I feel sorry for the Muslims trying to flee to get away from it. I guess they'd be called heretics from Islam. Dr. Bill Warner, have a great week coming up. Thank you for joining us. Boy, spot on with his warnings. And look, I'm hitting all the Islam stuff real hard right now because the clash of civilizations is coming down, folks. It's getting bad. All right, I'm about to hand the baton to David Knight, who is in the studio right next door to me. Again, I'm Alex Jones, your host. If you've tuned into this broadcast the first time, we're not liberal, we're not conservative. I'm just an American who wants to live in a free country and a free world. I believe in innovation. I believe in private property. I believe in classical liberal ideas of live and let live, like Thomas Jefferson. The modern liberal wants to control your speech with political correctness and wants to accept any outside culture, even if it's tyrannical, like Orthodox Islam, and wants to persecute you if you don't submit to it. New liberalism is a hate of the West, basically the hate of their daddy. Anything that looks like their daddy, they hate. It's a blow it up and start all over and let a bunch of lazy, snot-nosed, social justice warriors with four worthless degrees apiece and $500,000 in debt run our lives. It's a bunch of lazy, miserable, stupid pseudo-intellectuals that get together and basically take over society and civilization. But the reason I'm talking right now is this. I'm doing my first Reddit Ask Me Anything tonight. And that is at 6 to 8 o'clock. InfoWars Nightly News will be on right in the middle of it, so you can tune into that as well. But InfoWars.com/AMA is the page that you can go to, and you'll find that commercial-free two-hour transmission that we're doing. We're going to air some excerpts of it in the next week on the daytime show that airs 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central Standard Time. So, coming up, 6 o'clock tonight, we will kick that off. The feeds will be at InfoWars.com/show, but also InfoWars.com/AMA. Now, we're about to hand the baton to David Knight here. So much has happened. There's David Knight right there. He's in the other studio. If you're a Facebook Mentions viewer, or if you're watching us on cable stations like in Houston, or watching us over the internet, or listening to us on the radio, we are multimedia, truly independent, teleprompter-free, independent, red-blooded Americans, very race, color, and creed, who want to be free and want to be able to live and let live. And I've been on a jag lately because of these jihad attacks on the fact that we are letting more and more radical Muslims in, letting them attack and covering up when they attack, and that a worldwide jihad has been officially announced and kicked off, a major offensive by ISIS and Saudi Arabia because the West started pulling away from Saudi Arabia in the last 3 years, led by the U.S. Army, saying we're not backing Al-Qaeda and ISIS 4 years ago. You heard all that here. You learned all that here. Long before Cy Hirsch came on 6 months ago and said, we were right, this is true, incredible. I don't like being the person breaking news like that. It's dangerous. I did it because I have a responsibility. There is a war with criminal elements in our government, like Hillary Clinton, allied with Saudi Arabia, and there's other special interests too. But Saudi Arabia is activating terror networks worldwide and trying to hold us hostage. And the left in Europe said, yeah, we'll work with you, Saudi Arabia, and brought in 5 million people, a lot of them sleeper cells, to try to then declare civil emergencies against nationalists when the jihadists attack. So that's the big secret of what's going on. Now, you won't be able to hear David Knight in here because I have an earpiece. So let's go back in to the control room so we can hear a few minutes of David Knight's response to what I just said. And then we will hand the baton fully to David Knight. And I'll be back this evening, InfoWars.com/AskMeAnything/AMA. Or just go to InfoWars.com or PrismPlanet.com. You can't miss the links. We'll send it out on Twitter. We'll tweet it out, Real Alex Jones. And we're also going to send the links out in the InfoWars Insider newsletter, InfoWars.com/newsletter. Go there, throw your email in, and we can hit you with the link so you never miss anything, especially special events. So let's now go to David Knight. David Knight, please give me your take on what I just said, and then I am unplugging here, so the last 45 minutes is yours.
Alex, that's exactly right. You know, what we're looking at is, in the wake of this shooting, the left, Obama, Hillary Clinton, have tried to turn this into a gun control issue, but this is truly a border control issue. If you can't control the borders, if you're not willing to vet people who you're letting into this country, then what use is it going to be to even attempt to try to do gun control?
And I'm glad you said that, because they keep saying, Alex, you said this is tied to the refugees. This guy's a citizen, like they were saying this morning. A Frenchman stabbed and killed two today. He was from Algeria or Morocco.
And there was no gun involved there.
It's not a Frenchman. It's not exactly. But yeah. This guy's parents were Mujahideen, Al-Qaeda types. He came here. He was radicalized at home. He wasn't an American. He hated us. It makes my point. They're launching the jihad. So whether it's a guy that was here 20 years or whether it was somebody who got here 6 months ago, like the wife of the San Bernardino shooter, this is a jihad, and they hate the left more than anybody because they're twisted and classically, in a way, somewhat conservative. But it's all schizophrenic, like have sex with men under the booga booga, but if you don't do it that way, then you kill them. So it's all schizophrenic horse crap, okay, an illiberal bull by a bunch of pseudo-intellectual fops. I'm sorry, you just made a point I meant to make. I'm glad you made it, because they keep spinning it and saying, oh, we don't want to control the borders. This guy was already here, and it wasn't Islam, and it's all bull. Sorry, David, go ahead.
Well, you know, Alex, when you look at that French situation, and whether or not these people are first or second generation, there's an article that I'm going to talk about today via Drudge Report talking about more than half of the deadly attacks in the last decade have been done by second generation. We're going to talk about why that is. There's a good reason for that. And when we talk about what's going on, I saw comments from people, hey, he wasn't an immigrant. And these guys who shot up Paris weren't immigrants either. That's part of the problem, though, is how they bring the people in. But you got Hillary Clinton coming in and saying gun control is the only way to stop terrorists from getting the tools they need. And it's like, no, you have to worry. If you're going to let terrorists into your country without any kind of vetting, without any kind of control, the least of your worries is going to be them getting some kind of a semi-automatic weapon. What you really need to be worried about is that they're going to come in and use nuclear, biological, or chemical. Those are the real weapons of war. And what we saw in France, we saw a jihadi coming in using the weapons of jihad. What was he using? He was using a knife and he was using Facebook. Now, do we need to ban knives? And do we need to ban Facebook? Are those the problems? He stabs the French officer and this is a police commander. And this guy who committed this terrorist act was under observation already. So even though the police have him under observation, and they always say that, they say, yeah, we knew about him. I guess they don't want to pretend that they're ignorant. I guess it's better to say you're incompetent. But you need to know everything. You just don't want to be, I guess that's an excuse for being incompetent. But nevertheless, this guy was a known criminal. They said he was under observation, but he stabs the officer in the stomach, goes into the house, holds his wife hostage, eventually slits her throat in front of the three-year-old child. The two of them are bleeding out in front of the child, and this guy is filming it and putting it on Facebook and encouraging others to do the same. So let me ask you, is the problem a gun? Guns weren't involved there. Oh, yeah, the other were. I'm sorry. The guns were involved. At one point, the police showed up, and they put an end to it, saving the life of the three-year-old by shooting this guy with a gun. That's where the guns come in. And you see, it's always when the people with guns get there, the good guys with the guns stop the bad guys with the knives, with the nuclear weapons, with the biological weapons, with the chemical weapons, with their guns, whatever they choose to use. The issue is not gun control. The issue is border control. If you refuse to control the border, you will have these problems. Now, we're going to talk about that a little bit more. We're going to talk about some of the issues that show that it is border control. We're going to talk about what's coming up with gun control as well, because we've now got David Petraeus. He keeps betraying us. The regular at Bilderberg. And of course, you saw Rob Du chasing him down the streets in Dresden, Germany, at Bilderberg as Petraeus was running. It reminded me of, remember George H.W. Bush? Remember he ran, when he ran for president, everybody said, wait a minute, this guy doesn't believe in anything Ronald Reagan campaigned on. He criticized Ronald Reagan's lowering taxes, and he said, George Bush at the time said, no, that's nothing but voodoo economics. And so everybody was skeptical that George Bush would raise taxes, because Ronald Reagan lowered them quite a bit. Remember, Bernie Sanders says, hey, you know, taxes were 90% under Reagan. Yeah, before he lowered them, that's what he inherited. And then he lowered them to two brackets that were very, very low, somewhere in the 20s. And but, of course, Bernie would take it back there. Hillary would take it back there. And, of course, George H.W. Bush raised them quite a bit. As soon as, when he campaigned, he said, read my lips, no new taxes. Remember that? And then as soon as he got elected, he pushed through what then was the largest tax increase ever. George the First did, George H.W. Bush. And when he was asked about it, he kind of did the same thing that David Petraeus did to Rob Du there in Dresden. He was out jogging and he just smirked at the reporters and he said, read my hips. And he kept jogging. So I guess that's what David Petraeus was saying to Rob Du. Read my hips. I'm not going to talk to you. But what is David Petraeus doing now? David Petraeus is now betraying the veterans. Yes, he is leading a new gun control group that is going to focus on getting guns away from the veterans. And notice how he spends it. He says it's for their safety. CNN reports it says, 70% of the suicides of veterans are done with guns. So we need to take the guns away from veterans. And we've got this multi-star, I don't know how many stars they eventually gave this bureaucrat. He is nothing but a bureaucrat. I don't know how many stars they gave David Petraeus before he is eventually busted for selling secrets. But now they trot out this general, and they trot out also McChrystal, who was also there in Afghanistan. Remember, McChrystal has come out and said, hey, there's no way that you need to have military weapons in the United States in the hands of civilians. He said that multiple times. And he comes out, he talks about the velocity of the bullet and all this other kind of stuff. It's like, wow, I'm supposed to be impressed by that. Well, let's talk about the velocity of government control. Okay? At the time of the Revolution, when the Second Amendment was written, it was always about military weapons. Throughout history, they have always tried to take the state-of-the-art weapons away from the people in the populace. Okay, they banned crossbows from the people in England. They let them have longbows, but not crossbows. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. We're going to talk about Hillary getting busted by the Russians. Was it her private server at the DNC? We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show, this fourth hour, June 14th, Tuesday. I'm David Knight, and we're going to be talking about a variety of subjects. We've got a special report coming up in the next segment from John Bowne about the Orlando attack, a great special report. We're going to be playing that in the long segment. Also, I'm going to be talking about what's happening with Brexit, because Brexit is really about global governance. Brexit right now is a key issue of turning back and unraveling this plan of global consolidation. And of course, Donald Trump is another part of that issue as well, but that's going to be a few months from now. Brexit is coming up next week, and already we see in panic, we see the German banks have dropped into negative interest rates for the first time ever. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about what's going on with the polls and Brexit just a week away from that election, whether or not Britain is going to leave the European Union or not, as well as looking at the next step. You see, if you don't start to break down the European Union and these other economic trade groups that they've put together, that's the way they pull together and take away your sovereignty. First, they take away the control of your economy with these economic agreements, because these aren't simply free trade agreements. Anybody that sells you that, as we have been talking about this for a very long time, anybody says this is free trade is simply lying to you. Senator Sessions laid it out for people. He laid it out for Donald Trump, who understands this. We've talked about this multiple times. This is about global consolidation. First, they consolidate you economically. Then they control your economy outside of your country. Then they create crises. In response to those crises, they say, well, now we need to take further sovereignty away from you. So we're going to take a look at how the TPP is being used by the bankers to consolidate control and what they will do if this doesn't start to unravel. See, if Britain leaves, it's going to kick off a lot of referenda from a lot of different countries in the European Union that aren't being served by this, that understand they're getting a bad deal. We're also going to talk about some banker suicides. It's not just interest rates that are falling. We got actual bankers who are falling out of windows. Very interesting story. Of course, we covered this when it started happening a couple of years ago, all the rash of bankster suicides. Now the mainstream media is talking about it. Very interesting story from the New York Post that goes into the details of one of these particular suicides. I think you'll find that very interesting. Now, Alex was talking about this article we have on Infowars.com from Zero Hedge. Saudi Arabia has funded 20% of Hillary's presidential campaign. This is a claim from the Saudi crown prince. Not the clown prince, Saudi crown prince, okay? And by the way, it should be illegal for them to do this, but of course, being illegal is never a hindrance to Hillary Clinton. And when we look at the extraordinary influence that foreign governments have, and of course, they always go to the people who have the most to gain by controlling us, people like the Saudis or people like the Chinese. That's where the Clintons go to raise their funds because that's where they can multiply their leverage, okay? And as we're in the middle of Ramadan, as we've been reminded by this terrorist attack, remember that a couple of years ago, there was a lot of consternation about the fact that Obama had Ramadan ceremonies within the White House. You know, he wasn't the first one to do that. The first one to do that was Hillary Clinton. February 1996, the end of Ramadan. It's the Eid celebration. I guess that's how you pronounce it, E-I-D. I'm not Muslim, if you might have guessed, okay? She comes out and she says, this is an historic occasion, the first E-I-D celebration ever at the White House, okay, to celebrate the end of Ramadan. That was in 1996. Subsequent to that, they held it every year in the Clinton White House. And then, of course, George Bush kept up the tradition through all the Bush years. See, it's not just a Democrat thing. You got people like the Bushes who are in the pocket of the Saudis as well. And of course, it was Republicans and Henry Kissinger. It was Nixon and Kissinger who put the Saudis in the catbird seat as far as our currency is concerned. Remember Bretton Woods too? They said, we're not going to be on the gold standard anymore. Instead, we got this new deal. We got the petrodollar. We are going to, we've worked out this deal with the Saudis. They are going to prop up our currency by valuing all the oil and dollars, and then they agree to buy all these T-bill notes from us. And in exchange, we're going to do everything we can to keep the Saudi family in power. Now we see, as we've got the 9/11 report, the secret 28 pages, is there's been an effort for 15 years by the people who were leaders in the Senate, and we've got congressmen and senators saying we need to release this information. The American public needs to know what Saudi Arabia's involvement in 9/11 was. We have the CIA chief, Brennan, going to Saudi Arabia, going on Saudi television and assuaging their fears after the Saudis have threatened to blackmail us. They're clearly afraid of what might be revealed, but don't worry. Brennan, the CIA director, is going to cover for you, just like Hillary Clinton. That's the criminals in the White House in the pockets of the Saudis and the other Muslims. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this fourth hour, Tuesday, June 14th, 2016. We've got a great report from our reporter, John Bound, on the Orlando shooting that we're going to go to in just a moment. Before we do, I wanted to read you something from probably my closest friend back in North Carolina. He's had some health issues, and so we talked to him about doing some things like liver cleanse. He took that diet for several days and used liver cleanse, and he just sent me an update. He said, hey, I just want to give you guys an update. I'm feeling pretty amazing. I think this is what it must be to feel young again. I think the liver cleanse is the single best, fastest thing I've done for my health that has made the most perceptible difference in how I feel. He said, that's even more significant because it's in spite of a bad cold and arrhythmia. He's suffering from some heart arrhythmia. As a matter of fact, he's being monitored right now to see what the issue is. He says, I lost 6 or 7 pounds, could definitely see it in my face. Still, the primary benefit is in how I feel. Or maybe the weight loss is part of feeling lighter. Haha. But I wonder how much is water weight that would come back after resuming regular eating. I don't know. But I got to believe my liver can metabolize better without so many stones clogging it. So that's a personal friend of mine who's done the liver cleanse and is very happy with it. As a matter of fact, he's tried several supplements that we sell and is very happy with it, as I am. I use all this stuff as well. That's one of the reasons why we encouraged him to try that. Also, I want to let you know that we have at the InfoWars store a sale now on the Alexa Pure water filters. 20% off at theinfowarsstore.com. All Alexa Pure water filters are now 20% off, and this is just for a limited time. From the super high-quality gravity-fed Alexa Pure Pro water filter filtration system to the shower filters, now is the time to stock up for the lowest price. And again, gets rid of 99.9999%. There you go, Herman Cain. That's 99.999% of bacteria, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones. But this is for real. His tax plan wasn't, but this filter system is. You can get this now, all these filter products, like I said, from the gravity-fed large, the biggest system, all the way down to the shower filters, 20% off all Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com for a limited time only. Let's go to this report from John Bound, Orlando, America under attack by its own government.
Hours of June 12th, 29-year-old Omar Mateen, a registered Democrat, unleashed a jihad attack on the Pulse nightclub in Orlando, Florida, killing 49 and wounding 53 in the worst mass killing event in U.S. history.
Well, what Rodney, who is my friend who was a bartender that got shot 3 times, said in his own words is that when he was there, he specifically witnessed the assailant coming in. He saw that this guy... He didn't think he was going to be a threat. He just saw him coming in. So then moments after that, pulls out a rifle with semi-automatic capabilities and was shooting, you know, big caliber bullets. As soon as that happens, he literally hears the sound of bullets hitting people's skin, bullets piercing flesh, bullets breaking bones, people screaming, people crying, people in pandemonium. The other guy said that there was bodies dropping everywhere. And that the thing with Ronnie said, that was so crazy to him is that the person that he was serving in front of him, the person he was bartending with, died in front of him.
The amount of gunshots, and like, you know, you were trying to find out, just, I believe that there was more, yes, because...
So you believe there's more than one gunman there?
I believe that.
Omar Mateen, a U.S.-born citizen, had gradually self-radicalized. He had abused his first wife, yet no charges were filed. Unhinged behavior was reported by coworkers, but ignored because he was Muslim. And Mateen was interviewed by the FBI 3 times, but never put on any kind of list. He also traveled to Saudi Arabia 2 times to visit Mecca. Mateen worked as a security officer for a major DHS contractor, as Counter-Jihad reports. The Orlando nightclub terrorist who pledged allegiance to ISIS worked almost a decade for a major Department of Homeland Security contractor, raising alarms that ISIS sympathizers and agents have infiltrated the federal agency set up after 9/11 to combat terrorists. G4S uses fortified buses to transport hundreds of thousands of illegal immigrants from city to city and from cities to the U.S.-Mexican border. But earlier this month, Judicial Watch revealed G4S has been quietly moving and releasing van loads of illegal aliens away from the border to interior American cities. The security contractor also provides security guards and other security services for 90% of U.S. nuclear facilities. If anyone was a perfect candidate for being put on a watch list by the FBI or the DHS, it was Omar Mateen. Even his father is suspect, who pretended to be president of Afghanistan and also said gays should be killed. And the local imam in the Islamic community Mateen was a part of called for the death of gays.
Death is the sentence. I mean, look, there's nothing to be embarrassed about this. Death is the sentence.
The same mosque that Hillary Clinton herself blocked from being investigated. Kit Daniels writes, the Fort Pierce Islamic Center, where Mateen worshipped several times a week, was under investigation by both the FBI and the DHS as early as 2011 for ties to a worldwide Islamic movement known as Tablighi Jamal, which was linked to several terrorist organizations. But according to WorldNet Daily, the investigation was shut down under pressure from the Clinton-ran State Department and DHS's Civil Rights and Civil Liberties Office out of fear of offending Muslims, according to recently retired DHS agent Philip Haney. And now, Omar's brother-in-law is mocking our Second Amendment rights with his liberal swill posted on social media. Mateen's brother-in-law, Mustafa Abbasin, even went so far as to call Trump a Nazi and a racist. Breitbart reports, based on 2014 data, the most recent available data from the Department of Homeland Security, the number of green cards issued to Middle Eastern countries increased by 32%. The number of green cards issued to Afghan migrants increased by 379% in the course of that single year. Hillary Clinton has made clear that under a Clinton presidency, these numbers will grow substantially higher. Based on the minimum numbers Clinton has put forth thus far, the U.S. will resettle 730,000 permanent migrants from the Muslim world during her first term alone, adding up to be larger than the population of Washington, D.C.
Today marks the most deadly shooting in American history. The shooter was apparently armed with a handgun and a powerful assault rifle. This massacre is therefore a further reminder of how easy it is for someone to get their hands on a weapon that lets them shoot people in a school or in a house of worship or a movie theater or in a nightclub.
It only took 3 minutes for Obama to basically blame the American people. What would a real president have said? Take President Eisenhower, for instance. He would have simply told Americans to arm themselves under the Second Amendment. And now Obama has the nerve to call it homegrown terrorism.
As far as we can tell right now, this is certainly an example of the kind of homegrown extremism that all of us have been so concerned about for a very long time.
Obama, there is nothing even remotely resembling American values or culture in this attack. Stop using homegrown terror for your sound bites. You're clearly blaming the American people for beliefs that originate in the Middle East. They are not grown here at home. This new benchmark of the brutal slaughter of Americans on American soil is a clear indication that the FBI, DHS, and federal government are not only unable to do the job our tax dollars are funding, bottom line, they are growing the radical Islamic invasion. How about that for homegrown Obama?
Carlos the Jackal wrote a foreword to an Islamist book recently from prison. Of course, they let him do that. You know, he's got like a suite in prison. And it says that only a coalition of Islamist and socialist forces can defeat the United States. And in the Obama administration, we get a twofer. We've got them both covered, raised by Frank Marshall Davis in Hawaii, the communist, and then trained in madrasa schools. So we've got both of them in one, folded together in one. After the Benghazi attack, there were hearings at the State Department. A State Department official came out with a quote that should be in everybody's mind. The Taliban is inside the building. He was referring to Huma Abedin, Valerie Jarrett, and others who are allied closely with the Muslim Brotherhood. When Obama came in, he had all of the law enforcement and intelligence agency doctrines and training methods purged of any mention of Islamic Jihad. Imagine trying to fight World War II, but you were not allowed to say Nazi, SS, Gestapo, or Hitler because it would offend all the decent, moderate Germans. That's how crazy it is today.
Obama and anyone previously responsible or currently protecting this agenda that has breached our national security should immediately be arrested.
The transformation of America has been in the full swing ever since 2008. Now, there's no question, we got a hell of a job ahead of us. With the Muslim Brotherhood penetration in every one of our national security agencies, including all our intelligence agencies, and as been reported by some, our lead intelligence agency headed by a Muslim convert, this is not going to be an easy task.
The longer these Saudi Arabian lackeys are in power, the more Americans will be slaughtered. Stop the madness. Arm yourselves, America. Aggressively protect your First and Second Amendment rights. The globalists are bringing a war to your backyard. John Bound for Infowars.com.
Great report by John Bound. As you heard at the very end, he quoted retired Navy Admiral James Ace Lyons saying, "We reportedly have someone running our intelligence community that is a converted Muslim." That would be Brennan. Now, John Brennan is somebody who has been a lawyer covering for Obama's policy of assassination and other issues. But I think it was very telling that he went to Saudi Arabia just recently. As I mentioned in the last segment, he said to them on Saudi television, imagine, have you ever heard of a CIA director going to a foreign country that is being accused of assisting a terrorist act in our country? Have you ever heard of the CIA chief going? And of course, they didn't have the CIA at the time. We had Hitler and Nazi. But what if we had the CIA during the Cold War? What if the CIA chief went to Russian television and said, don't worry, there's an investigation of you spying on us or doing something to us, but they're not going to find anything. I guarantee they're not going to find anything. This is what John Brennan did. He went to Saudi Arabia, went on live television. They translated his comments into Arabic, overdubbed it in Arabic. And he said, I think the 28 pages will be published. I support their publication. Everyone will see the evidence that the Saudi government had nothing to do with it. He's going to take care of that for them. And this is a guy, and this one of the reasons, well, besides people reporting that they have firsthand knowledge of this, look at the public acts of this man. Besides going to Saudi television this last week, this is a guy who refused to take the oath of office on the Bible. He wouldn't swear on the Bible. Now, of course, the Muslim congressman, I think it's Keith Ellison out of Michigan, if my memory serves me correctly, he would not take the oath of office on the Bible. What John Brennan did, he didn't want to pull out a Quran, so he said, I'll take it on the Constitution. But, of course, then he says, we've got to get rid of the Fourth Amendment, that Constitution that he swore the oath on. So he would not swear the oath of office on a Bible. He has gone to Mecca, to places where non-Muslims have never been allowed to go. And he also, within the intelligence community, has banned the term jihad from being used within the intelligence community. So if John Brennan is not a Muslim convert, he is a definitely doing everything he can to support what they are doing. And again, Hillary Clinton, who is has gotten 20% of her campaign from the Saudis, is telling us that the only way we're going to stop these terrorist attacks is to stop them from getting the weapons they need. She says it's essential we stop terrorists from getting the tools they need to carry out the attacks. So she's using that to argue for gun control. We have to turn this around. We have to say this is not an argument. This is not a situation that's going to be solved by gun control. It's not going to be solved by background checks. The guy was investigated three times by the FBI. He was given statewide licenses by the state. He was hired by the largest private security firm in the world. None of these background checks, including the ones where he legally bought weapons at a store, not online, as Hillary Clinton is intimating that he did. No, he bought them at a store. He had all the background checks, and he was vetted at every level, federal, state, Homeland Security, his private employer. Nobody found anything on this guy. More background checks aren't going to do it. If we can't do background checks like that on people coming in that are here, how are we going to do background checks on the people coming across the border? How are you going to have gun control if you can't have border control? So they don't want that. As I pointed out, the people who have been responsible for over half of the deadly attacks in the past decade are second-generation people like this shooter in Orlando. Why is that? Well, think about it. What are they being taught in school? They're being taught that the U.S. is bad. They're being taught by that by our federally controlled schools. They're being taught that white privilege is bad, the founders are bad, the principles this country was founded upon are bad. They've got their social justice committees that they're now setting up in schools, which sound like some kind of a Marxist nightmare. But, of course, they don't want them to identify with America. They don't want them to join America. We used to talk about how America was the great melting pot. Everybody brings something into the country, and we all mix it together, and we get something that didn't exist before anywhere else, some unique blend of all these backgrounds and cultures. They don't want that. They don't want the melting pot. They want the tossed salad. They want people to remain distinct, because if they remain distinct and separate from each other in their own little enclaves, or in the case of the Muslims, and their own self-set-up and self-maintained ghettos, because they don't want to mix with the outside people. And that happens in many cases. They encourage them not to learn the language. They want us to pay for their education in a different language other than English. So they don't even want them to have a common language with us. What was the Tower of Babel about? Oh, you separate people by language, and they can't work together. They won't work together. It'll be the foundation of confusion and conflict. And that is what our government is engineering with these people who come in. That's why the second generation is worse than the first. They have no concept of the places that they came from, that even though their parents may not like, they may not feel comfortable in this culture, they know that what they came from was worse than what they have here. But the kids don't know that. And the kids don't want to be identified as American, because that's got too many connotations of, you know, being connected to these white males and stuff. So let's come up with a separate identity. And that's when you get these La Raza judges that are coming against Trump. That's when you get this shooter in Orlando. Okay? These people come in like this judge, heavily pushing La Raza, push everything for the race. For people outside of the race, nothing. And he comes against Trump. It was about La Raza, just like it's about Islam for this guy. This guy mocked his classmates and celebrated at 9/11. He said, this is what America deserves. And then he shoots 50 people because the second generation hates us the most. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. I want to talk about the subtle ways that the media and the politicians control us with language. Just a subtle difference will make all the difference in the world. Before I do, we have a special on Alexa Pure water filters. All of our filters, from the largest filters down to the shower filters, are now 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com. That's the Alexa Pure filtration system that removes 99.999% of bacteria, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones, all the way down to the shower filter. That's for a limited time only, 20% off all the Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, how do they subtly do this? Well, let's take a look at the Washington Post, which has really turned into a master propaganda organization lately when it comes to Donald Trump especially. They put out this story saying the Russian government hackers have penetrated the DNC, the Democrat National Committee. They stole opposition research on Trump. Oh, see, they didn't get anything on the Democrats. It's only on Trump. See how they pivot this? It's an amazing spin they put on this thing to say, oh, this wasn't, they don't want you to think about, or maybe subtly, you know, pushing this away from Hillary Clinton. You think that this was on a private server? Do you think that the Russian government had interest in Hillary Clinton's private server when she was Secretary of State? You think if they could hack the DNC's private server that they would have hacked her server? Of course they would have. We just reported last week, 50 times now, it's come out in a FOIA request, 50 times the Federal Reserve has been hacked into by multiple sources, okay? They're looking at their deliberations as to whether or not they're going to raise or lower interest rates. Because as the people said when the Federal Reserve was being created, Senator Lindbergh said, you're giving people the power to manipulate markets, to make them rise, to make them fall, to know the timing of those rises and falls in the marketplace. You're giving them incredible power and wealth to do that. And, of course, people can now hack. If you've got the right tools, you can now hack into the private discussions of the Federal Reserve and get that information. Or you can get all of the federal government's data on all of its employees. That's been done, too. So why wouldn't we think that they would get Hillary Clinton's private email server? The Washington Post spins it and says, oh, it was about Donald Trump. They're getting opposition research on Donald Trump. You think they can't get that elsewhere? You think the... Do you think the Democrats know something about Donald Trump that the Russians don't know? Come on. They're just trying to push you away from that. Here's another example of subtle deceit. And that's the new gun control group that David Petraeus is putting out there. They call it the Veterans Coalition for Common Sense. And they're going to be coming after the guns of veterans. And David Petraeus says this. He says, we need to do more to prevent gun tragedies. As service members, each of us swore an oath to protect our Constitution and the homeland. Now we're asking leaders to do more to protect our rights and save lives. Yes, please protect our rights and take away our guns. Please honor your oath to the Constitution and destroy it. We got Paul Ryan saying a Muslim ban is not in our country's interest, coming out and attacking Donald Trump. He's never attacked Obama like this, but he attacks Donald Trump. And he misstates it. He says, I do not think a Muslim ban is in our country's interest. Paul Ryan, that is a lie. Donald Trump has never called for a Muslim ban. The Hill actually got it right. They were actually honest about this. They say Trump doubled down on his plan to temporarily ban nearly all Muslims. Okay, it's a temporary ban, not to ban everybody forever. That's the way they're spinning this, okay? That's another subtle thing. But then sometimes they're not so subtle. This new article from Kit Daniels, Rolling Stone demands a repeal of the Second Amendment. This is a constitutional lawyer, so-called constitutional lawyer, says the Second Amendment is a threat to liberty. Sometimes we just have to acknowledge the founders and the Constitution are wrong, said David Cohen in the Rolling Stones magazine. This is one of those times. We need to say it loud and clear. The Second Amendment must be repealed. No, get rid of Rolling Stones magazine. It's a piece of trash. So is David Petraeus. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm David Knight.